drivers and Danica, start your engines!
Pull those belts down tight one more time. Warm up those tires. Hit your marks and let's go racing, boys and girls. NASCAR, IndyCar, Formula One, Formula E, NHRA, and local dirt track and drag strip racing talk. This is the fastest hour in radio. Where'd you go? Here's your host, Steve West and Dustin Harmer, with producer John Myers.
Aha. The program button.
You're getting there.
That, you know.
It's like riding a bike. That's all it is. You just got to remember.
There's so many buttons.
I know. As far as that's concerned, of the three people that were mentioned, two of us are here. Plus, Matt Nicholson is here. Welcome in. Turn the button on that one.
Hello.
All right. See? It's all the buttons.
This is what happens when you don't run a board for months.
I know. That's why we have producer John Myers.
And they put new boards in here with all kinds of new buttons on top of the 30,000 buttons I already have.
Good morning to you. It is, well, regardless of whether you're for or against it, the day after.
Think totally four.
I understand. I'm just saying, regardless of whether you like him or you hate him, guess what? Donald Trump's the president, and this is the day after his inauguration.
Yes.
Yep.
I've gone back and forth on this, and you know what? I'm kind of done. I'm not going to do this anymore. Here's the thing, folks. Again, I don't care whether you like or hate Donald Trump. It doesn't matter. The man took the oath of office legally.
Yep.
He's your president.
Boom.
He is the president of these United States of America.
That's right.
We had to deal with it for 8 years under Barack Obama. Now it's your turn.
What's fair is fair.
All right, now we're done with political.
Yes, we are.
That said, you may have heard the weather forecast from our partners over at WVTM Channel 13 here in Birmingham. There is a tornado watch in effect for central parts of Alabama in and around the Birmingham area and points south. Beware of that. That's in effect until 11 a.m. if we hear of anything, we'll let you know. That's, you know, if it becomes warning time, we'll let you know.
My poor puppy.
Oh yeah,
home alone,
scared.
Scared to death. She hears thunder and she runs right to the kennel.
Well, you know,
hey, smart dog.
Yeah,
it's a good place.
Lock me in. Lock me in, man.
So anyway, yeah, that's in effect until 11 a.m. I'm Steve West. That is Dustin Harmer. Good morning.
What's up?
And our newest addition to the show officially as of last week, Matt Nicholson. How are you, sir?
Good morning, gentlemen.
Wow, what a difference. We talk about differences in weeks here in the state. Think about it. Two weekends ago, 7 degrees.
Yeah.
And we had a race called the Ice Bowl that was literally iced out.
Yes.
Last week, sunny, 70, 75 degrees. Beautiful racing.
Beautiful.
Fantastic time out of Talladega Super Speedway. This weekend, tornado watch. Welcome to Alabama.
Yeah, if you don't like the weather, wait 5 minutes.
Yeah, and get the entire gamut over the course of a three-week period.
Yeah.
Anyway, we appreciate you checking us out. Coming up a little bit later on this morning, assuming everything rolls fine for him coming up here, Joey Jatina is going to be in studio, so we're going to be talking with him. He's got some plans coming up. We'll be talking with you as well about some plans that you've got coming up as well, because you're starting to get a little bug there as far as you watched it last week.
And yep.
It's
he's
time.
Feeling the itch.
Yeah, it's like... Come on.
Go ahead and scratch it like Clint Boyer.
What? Yeah. Scratch it.
That's right. So let's get into the news here as much as we can so we can give them time to talk. Plus, we'll be talking with Rowdy and Mark about what's going on with ARCA. Let's see. Mark was at Chili Bowl.
Yes, yeah. Mark was at the Chili Bowl.
Yeah.
Rowdy was at Talladega Short Track.
Yeah, he was at Talladega Short Track. Probably knows a pretty good bit about the preseason testing that happened last weekend for ARCA at Daytona. Hopefully we'll get Late Model Mark in as well. So we got a lot of stuff that we want to get to. So
yes.
Here we go with what we usually do here as the fastest hour in radio and in racing. Sponsorship is everything. As a result, the season-opening non-points race, The Clash at Daytona, now has a title sponsor. It's Advance Auto Parts. They signed what Sports Business Daily touts as a multi-year deal. I love these things because they never detail exactly how many years these multi-year deals are.
Could be 2, could be 12, could be 40.
It's just multi-year.
Yeah.
The race in the previous couple of seasons, we've known it as the Sprint Unlimited, but of course Sprint ended their title sponsorship deal with NASCAR, and away went the race sponsor for that, and the All-Star race, and is at least those two.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm.
Yeah.
Daytona officials decided to bring back the very first name of the event, The Clash. As it was known in 1979, it was specifically the Busch Clash, but in this case, well, Busch is, well, they're on the car for Kevin Harvick.
That's right.
Not sponsoring the race. So they brought back The Clash. Cool. I like it. In addition to the race title sponsorship, the deal between the track and the auto parts chain makes Advance Auto Parts the official parts store of Daytona International Speedway as well.
Mm-hmm.
With the sudden announcement of last week, Carl Edwards stepping away, not retiring, stepping away from Monster Energy Cup Racing, it was determined Daniel Suarez is moving up to the number 19 Camry in the Xfinity Series to the number 19 Camry in the Cup Series. Also left kind of a dilemma for NASCAR, whether to allow the number 19 onto the track at Daytona for that cash grab event that we just talked about, the Advance Auto Parts Clash at Daytona. That's going to take some getting used to.
Yeah.
Yeah, that is. We have a lot to get used to this year.
Yeah, no kidding. Monster Energy Cup, not the least of which. Turns out NASCAR will allow Daniel Suarez in here. We'll get to the back and forth on this. Here's the details. NASCAR talked to Joe Gibbs Racing when it was determined that JGR was well into preparations of the 19 for the race, slated to be run February the 18th, which means less than a month.
Can it hurry up, please?
Yeah, no kidding. Anyway, so they figured, they put all the effort, they put all the money into it, so candidate for 2017 Sunoco Rookie of the Year, going to be the first Mexican-born driver to compete in the Cup Series. And we'll take Edwards' 6 pole positions that he garnered last season to get the car into the 75-lap event, and it will be Daniel Suarez. Dustin first.
Yeah. let's just go on. Let me just start this much. No. Okay? Just simply put, no. I heard about this come down. Matt and I were talking about it a little bit Facebook Messenger last night.
Yeah.
And I just, for the life of me, I don't understand why they're going to allow him to step into the role where Carl Edwards was. Carl Edwards is the one that got the poles, not Daniel Suarez. I do not agree with this at all. He didn't earn them. He was not in the car. He should not be getting the chance to be in the Clash. Once Carl Edwards left, sorry to Aris, 19, Joe Gibbs Racing, that now spot should be defunct because your boy didn't get a pole.
Two things real quick. Number one, cost of putting that kind of a car, a Cup Series car together, what, quarter mil?
Easy.
Easy.
Very easy.
So quarter mil to $500,000. Yeah. That's a pretty hefty outlay.
Mm-hmm.
To just then all of a sudden be told, no, you're not going to run it.
Yeah.
But that said, your opinion equals Dustin's.
It does. And the reason I say it does, by them circumventing the rules like they did and allowing him to get in, that's basically saying the car earned that spot.
Yeah.
Instead of saying that if it would have been a driver earned spot in that race. Mm-hmm. That's saying the car earned that spot. So in turn, Clint Bowyer legitimately has a gripe.
Ah, are we ready for this?
He does. He does have a gripe.
He legitimately has a gripe.
Yes,
here comes part B of that. As opposed to Daniel Suarez, Stewart Haas Racing's prior knowledge, this is NASCAR's terminology, Stewart Haas Racing's prior knowledge of Tony Stewart's retirement from Cup Racing means that Clint Bowyer is not able to pilot the number 14 in the event, despite Stewart's record, he did get a pole position last year, making the 14 eligible. Then there's the third part of this. Alex Bowman is going to substitute for Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the number 88 because Bowman qualified for the event, not Earnhardt Jr., Bowman qualified for the event by gaining the pole at the Phoenix Chase race, the second-to-last race of the year last year.
Right.
Hendrick wanted to reward him. There are no plans to enter Bowman in any other Cup races at this point in time for Hendrick Motorsports, which is kind of a shame because Alex Bowman is even part-time on the Xfinity Series, so I kind of feel for that guy right there.
Yeah.
So Alex Bowman will be in. Daniel Suarez will be in. But despite the fact that, as you said, the car technically has a pole to it, Clint Bowyer will not be able to put the 14 in the event.
Right.
And we know Tony Stewart's not going to do
it. That's my problem with it.
Yeah, that's my problem too. You know, they're going to allow Suarez to substitute for Carl Edwards and take the car that earned the pole, since now the car drives itself,
yeah,
and allow him to do it. But they will not allow Clint Boyer to do the same thing in place of Tony Stewart.
Right.
That whole thing, it's this. You talked about it a minute ago, circumventing the rules.
Yeah.
Now you've opened the rules to a whole new degree. Because now anybody has a legitimate reason why they should be in the Clash, the Advanced Auto Parts Clash, each year at Daytona International Speedway, based on what's going on now.
Yeah.
But you don't know which way it's going to fall. Are you going to fall towards the Clint Boyer side, or are you going to fall towards the Daniel Suarez side? Alex Bowman, he earned that spot. He earned the pole. He earned his spot in the race.
And classy move by Rick Hendrick to go ahead and put him in that car.
I completely agree. We talked about it on the show just a couple weeks ago when that took place, when we found that out and everything else. Was the fact that, you know, that's awesome. That's great. He earned that spot. Now, what does that say for Daniel Suarez? What does that say for the NASCAR side of the house, where they allowed Daniel Suarez to do it when Alex Bowman earned it, Tony Stewart earned it, Carl Edwards earned it, Suarez is in, Boyer's out, Bowman's in, Bowman should be in, and Clint Boyer should be in. Suarez, out.
Exactly. And, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, doesn't Earnhardt Jr. have that past champions pass into the race?
Yes.
He does.
Okay, now he willingly gave up his seat to Alex Bowman because Alex Bowman earned it.
Right.
Yeah.
Now, Hendrick could have easily said, okay, Bowman's going to drive the five, Earnhardt keeps his spot.
Could have.
Could have easily, but, you know, we're all three on the same page. Suarez didn't earn that.
Yeah.
He didn't earn it. That's basically, they turned around and said, the car earned the spot.
Congratulations.
Your car
to the
earned
fact
it.
That
here you
money
go.
Now buys you races.
Yeah, I do kind of. I am a little curious as to exactly how much money might have been involved in that situation. Because I get the feeling there was something changing hands there.
Going really back to last season, and, you know, gave Suarez tons of props. Great kid, very talented guy, everything else. But this leaves a bad taste in my mouth when it comes to Daniel Suarez now.
Here's the other thing to think about when it comes to this. And this is going to actually be a benefit to Daniel Suarez if you stop and think about it. Because now we've got all four Joe Gibbs Racing cars in there. Okay?
Yes.
Kyle Busch is in there. Denny Hamlin's in there. Matt Kenseth is in there. Now you got Daniel Suarez in there.
Mm-hmm.
This gives Daniel Suarez 75 laps of practice at Daytona. In a car that he is unfamiliar with.
Free 75-lap test session.
Yeah, I mean, it may be a Toyota Camry, but I'm sorry. The Toyota Camry in the Xfinity Series and the Toyota Camry in the Cup Series are two different vehicles.
Oh, of course, yes.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so this gives him 75 laps of practice that technically Clint Boyer doesn't get.
Yeah, that's the other part of the gripe, the fact that, you know, Boyer doesn't get to test in a new car that he's getting into before Daytona.
Mm-hmm.
He'll get the normal practice like everybody else.
Yeah.
He doesn't get that extra time like Daniel Suarez. The consistency level that we're seeing out of NASCAR world, a lot of things, is really falling by the wayside.
Stewart Haas
is a huge issue here.
Stewart Haas Racing had three cars that became eligible to go into this in Kurt Busch, Kevin Harvick, and Tony Stewart's car.
Yes.
Okay. Kurt Busch and Kevin Harvick are going to be in it, obviously.
Of course.
That'll help them get used to the shirt that you're particularly wearing, the brand that's on it. I can't believe that he actually put that on. We'll get back to that in a minute. But anyway, they're getting used to an entirely brand new make. They're going from Chevrolet to Ford.
Yes.
They need to get now some new notes. There's going to be some things that you can kind of cross over from one car make to another. But in the end, you're still getting used to an entirely brand new make of car.
Exactly. And you're not getting the testing like you're used to getting and everything else, because that's kind of down now.
Yeah.
So you're not getting time to do anything whatsoever when it comes to getting prepped for any racing.
Clint Boyer is stuck on the outside.
See what I'm sitting here looking at? If I'm not mistaken, and I could be very real wrong, I think past 500 pole sitters are allowed in the Clash too. I've seen that somewhere, but I'm not sure on it.
Well, the problem with this race
is... Well, yeah, actually, he's right, because that would make Danica Patrick...
That automatically puts the 10 car eligible.
That does put the 10 car in there.
Four Stewart
cars. So three out of the four Stewart Haas Racing cars are in, although all four technically are eligible, but they did allow all four Joe Gibbs Racing cars to be in there, even though technically only the car is eligible.
Basically, with the addition of Suarez being foolishly entered into this race and allowed by NASCAR, if you can breathe and you can open your eyes... And you can use your hands. You can ultimately make it into the Advanced Auto Parts Clash at Daytona.
Find me a car.
Well, if we could do a temporary Clint Bowyer stepping outside of the vehicle for a little while, we could put Matt in the 14. And because Stuart Haas Racing didn't know about it, NASCAR should allow Matt to run.
Exactly.
I am, as soon as you said that, all I see is the scene from Talladega Nights where Ricky Bobby's in the car the first time.
I want to go fast.
And he's like, I just want to tell you, this is the coolest thing I've ever done in my whole life.
Come on, man.
I want to go fast. New racing team coming up here in the Monster Energy Cup Series for 2017. It's Gaunt Brothers Racing. They've announced they're actually returning to NASCAR. They're going to field a Toyota Camry sponsorship from Castrol Motor Oil and Lordco Auto Parts. That's a Canadian-based company, both of them actually, just like Gaunt Brothers Racing is. DJ Kennington's been named the driver of the car. Who?
I'm going to have to Google him.
Yeah. DJ Kennington's named the driver of the car. He will run at least four races this coming season. I say at least four. Kennington's the only driver signed at this time, and the only race that he's signed to run is the Daytona 500. The team said that they're going to announce drivers at a later date, so it could be Kennington coming back. They're planning on running all four restrictor plate races, both Daytona, both Talladega. As far as whether they enter any more, we don't know yet. Gaunt Brothers Racing, if you don't know about him, is owned by a man by the name of Marty Gaunt. He's the owner of Triad Racing Technologies. Before forming up Triad and then this racing team, Gaunt worked with Team Penske, Red Horse Racing, and Red Bull Racing. Hey, remember when they were in NASCAR?
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a long
it's
time
been
ago.
A while.
GBR ran in NASCAR's Pinty Racing Series back in 2011. Partner Rab Racing, the Rab Racing is going to supply them the cars, the shop space, and the technical support for GBR. Pardon me for all of my knowledge that I may have about racing, but I'm sorry, NASCAR's Pinty Series? I don't know this one.
That one.
The Canadian Tire Series.
I was thinking it was a typo.
Is that the same thing?
Yep.
Got it.
I was thinking it was a typo at first, but now.
I was thinking it was a typo at first, too, then I started going through, and I kept getting the same thing from about eight different websites, and I'm like, okay, well, it's got to be that.
Yeah, I saw that in a lineup. I was like, is Steve trying to throw me a curveball here? What is this?
You want to talk about throwing a curveball? I was the one that had to try and catch the thing. It was more like a knuckleball.
It was going left, and I was going right.
Okay, so this is effectively the Canadian version of NASCAR. Yes. Canadian, gotcha. Yep. Okay, that makes a heck of a lot more sense.
Yep.
So
is that the Pinto series?
Pinto series.
Pinty.
Pinty. I'm sorry, Pinty. Yeah. I don't have my computer in front of me, so I can't reread that word.
Now, I cannot honestly say that maybe Ford didn't sell the Pinto in Canada as the Pinty.
I meant to say Pinta, not Pinto.
As in the Nina, the Pinta, and the Santa Maria?
Exactly. It's a bad morning.
Gosh.
It's unreal. The shirt.
It must be. You're in rare form. Rick Ware Racing, that's a tongue twister if you say it too fast, said that they are going to be running full-time this coming season in the Cup Series, even though that they are an open or non-chartered organization, if you will. Hey, the number 51 comes back from Scott Motorsports.
Bless you.
Thank you. The number 51 Chevrolet SS going to have Timmy Hill behind the wheel at Daytona. Beyond that, the team is set to feature a rotation of several drivers. They include Hill, Stanton Barrett, Cody Ware, and road course ringer Kevin O'Connell, among others.
The new 32 car.
Yeah, pretty much. But Rick Ware Racing says we're full-time. Ware stated the team bought the assets of Tommy Baldwin Racing's erstwhile Cup Series program, got the cars and other equipment that's just, well, I'm not going to get into the basics of it. Sponsorship of the Cup team, according to the organization, will come at a later date. For their particular situation, I hope so.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, also, Ware has said that Rick Ware Racing will also be running a full-time entry in the Camping World Truck Series with one driver, Spencer Boyd.
Yeah. There's your new go fast car.
Yeah.
But in a Chevrolet brand.
Yeah, in a lot of ways. We've talked about going back and forth between driver to driver to driver to driver here. Yeah. And even if you have the same crew chief, every driver's got their own way of looking at things. If, you know, for example, our normal producer who's somewhere in here, how's it going, man? Good to have you. Joey Jatina is in the building, so we'll be talking with him starting up here in just a minute. But let's say that John, as our producer, becomes the crew chief for Fastest Hour in Radio Racing, and we decide that we're going to do a trio of drivers between Dustin, Matt, and myself.
Mm-hmm.
Dustin likes the car one way, you like the car another, I probably like the car a third way, but yet the crew chief, John, has to try and figure out how to fix the car each and every week to match Dustin, and then you, and then me.
Yes, finding that balance.
Talk about stress.
Yeah, I mean, the lack of consistency there, it's hard for me to think that they're going to have any kind of success here, even though that they're in all 36 points races.
Yeah. It's, yeah. you're spot on with that.
Yeah, because once you get, and the thing is once you do find a comfort zone, mm-hmm. then it switches up. So every time you find that comfort zone, all of a sudden it's something different, you know, every time you turn around. So you can't really get in a groove. You can't get in any motion to really capitalize.
It's like if Dustin drives it, say, Atlanta. Mm-hmm. He's like, all right, I like the car loose. I like it loose. You know, here we go. I get in the car at Vegas. All right, tighten it up. I like a tight car.
Yeah. So now we got to go to the exact opposite.
Back to the drawing board. Go to completely to the opposite end of the spectrum. And, you know, John's probably sitting over going, oh, I'm ready to kill everybody, you know. But that's
take stock in Rolaids.
You're going to need them. Exactly.
You're going to get an ulcer.
Probably would. Over to Darlington Raceway, which has announced their plans for their upcoming throwback weekend. Darlington Speedway president Kerry Tharp. You said 90s?
I said early 90s. I was close.
He was. I give him props.
Yeah. He said that they're going to celebrate the 1985 to 1989 time period of the sport during this coming throwback weekend. Quote, as we enter the third year of our throwback campaign, focusing on drivers, personalities, and moments that were compelling in that time frame, such as the emergence of Dale Earnhardt, senior, not junior, of Bill Elliott winning the first Winston Million, and the growth of the NASCAR Xfinity Series, which at that time was known as the Busch Grand National Series.
Yeah.
It's going to be an exciting era for the track and industry to celebrate, said Tharp. The ticket for the event also has something of a throwback design. It shows images in the main part of the ticket from 1987 Southern 500 winner Dale Earnhardt himself, last year's race winner Martin Truex Jr. That's the main part again. Also, along the bottom edge of the ticket as you hold it and readable, several other iconic NASCAR drivers, Richard Petty back in the day holding up a Darlington trophy, Bobby Allison sitting with Tony Stewart at last year's race with the throwback car sitting behind them, and Bill Elliott holding that aforementioned Winston Million check. That's I've looked at the ticket. Cool ticket design. Really, really cool ticket design there. And it'd be a lot of fun to be able to go back and check out that throwback weekend at some point in time.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Three schemes I want to see.
All right.
If somebody will bring back the old Kodak scheme from the late 80s.
Well, the old number four.
The old four.
Now, correct me if I'm wrong, that was before Sterling Marlin. That would have been Eddie...
Ernie Irvin.
Ernie Irvin?
Ernie Irvin had it, and then I think it was Rick Wilson.
Between 85 and 89?
I think Rick Wilson had it in 88, 89, somewhere in there.
All right, so that's one.
Give me the gold and white Miller High Life scheme that Bobby Allison had.
Oh, yeah. Number 12, if 12. I remember correctly.
And give me the Coors Light scheme of Bill Elliott, and I'll be happy.
Would Chase run that?
It'd be nice if he did. It'd be real
fun.
Nice if he did.
It'd be kind of fun to see who all would be there. And there's other ones that are in there in that particular time frame. Obviously, you got the Darrell Waltrip side of things. Mm-hmm. You could do one of two, quite frankly.
Yeah.
When he was running for Junior Johnson, had the Mountain Dew look, and then he went over to Hendrick.
The Tide car.
Yeah. And he also had a Pepsi Challenger in there as well. So there's actually three, I guess, that you could run there.
Yeah.
So there's him. You mentioned Bobby Allison. I was trying to remember who else. Rusty Wallace?
Won that 27
won the
car.
Championship in 89.
89, yeah.
The 27
Kodiak
car.
Yep.
So that could be possible in there. If only Pontiac would come back. General Motors. Down to the Xfinity Series, Hunt Brothers Pizza Junior Motorsports signed a multi-year deal. There's that multi-year deal thing again. To continue the Xfinity Series partnership, the deal goes through this year and next. It's going to be assigned to the number one Chevrolet Camaro of Elliott Sadler. For now, the convenience store pizza chain is going to be the primary sponsor on that car for two races, Atlanta and Kansas. We already know that they're going to do four races with Kevin Harvick.
Yes.
So they're not only going to be on a Chevy Camaro, they're going to be on a Ford Mustang.
That's promotion.
Really weird.
Yeah, it is. It's kind of odd. Meantime, it's also been reported Sadler is going to get his crew chief Kevin Meandering back for 2017. The pairing of driver and crew chief combined for three wins last year, but Meandering was suspended for the championship race in 2016 because of two loose lug nuts found on the car at the end of the prior race at Phoenix, so he had to sit the Homestead Miami race out. Well, he's coming back. Apparently, they decided that, you know what, we're not going to penalize you for that.
It's always a good thing.
Yeah. Well, stability.
It's all about stability.
Something like that. Camping World Truck Series reports Nemco Motorsports expands to a two-truck operation, a father and son combination, too. John Hunter Nemechek, who took over the organization's one truck midway through 2014 when he made the age minimum by NASCAR rules. And then, of course, last year got his first full season in the Camping World Truck Series, finished eighth in final points. Now word has it his dad either was getting bored, couldn't stand to see his son having all the fun. I don't know what it was. So front row Joe Nemechek is coming out of retirement to drive a second, what had been termed as a full-time entry, but I'm not so certain. We're getting varying reports here. The elder Nemechek, who's driving the number 87 Chevy Silverado, has got sponsorship with the company Fleet Wing. John Hunter is going to continue in the number 8 Silverado with sponsorship from Fire Alarm Services. This will mark the first time that a father and son have raced together in the top series of NASCAR since 2006. It's when Bobby Hamilton Sr. and Bobby Hamilton Jr. were on the track at the same time at Daytona. Number 87, not, according to one other report, going to be a full-time entry. One says it is, one says it's not. I'm going to go not.
I'm going flashback right now.
Yeah?
Because you go back to last year with John Hunter Nemechek.
Yeah.
At, you know, which road course was that? Was that?
Canadian Tire.
Yeah.
Was it? Yeah. The infamous, let's wreck it to the checkers. Could you imagine
tires.
If it comes down to him and Daddy?
Ooh.
Dad will take son out in a heartbeat.
You know, that would be a great spear. Yeah. More, you know, WWE in your house type thing.
Time to learn a lesson, son.
Come here, boy.
NEMCO Motorsports officials said they're looking into what events past the season opener at Daytona they're going to put the second truck in. That's why I give it more credence that it's a part-time entry than a full-time entry. But, yeah, dad and son on the track at the same time. Pretty cool. And Parker Kligerman going to get a chance to come back to NASCAR. We'll detail that when we come back. Hey, we're at full strength now. Plus one. Welcome into Joey Giottina. We'll be saying officially hi to him when we come back from this break here on the Fastest Hour in Radio.
Listening to the Fastest Hour in Radio on Superstation 101.
Every day in the United States, more than 41,000 blood donations are needed. This is State Health Officer Dr. Tom Miller. The winter months traditionally yield lower numbers of blood donations, but that doesn't mean that the need for blood at hospitals and emergency treatment facilities goes down. A blood donation is a gift of life. For more information and resources to help find locations to donate blood in your area, visit our website at adph.org.
This message brought to you by the Alabama Department of Public Health and this station.
The American Red Cross urgently needs blood and platelet donations and asks donors to schedule an appointment to give now. Your blood donation matters to the patients counting on life-saving transfusions. Visit redcrossblood.org.
The human voice. It can be sweet as music, powerful as thunder,
and so, my fellow Americans,
cheerful as laughter. But for millions of people, it can also be a sign of COPD. This serious lung disease can make it so hard to breathe, you often can't catch a breath or finish a sentence, let alone carry a tune. And many who have COPD don't even know it. That's where your voice comes in. If you think you or a loved one have symptoms, talk with a healthcare provider. Early diagnosis can mean better treatments and quality of life. Join us in raising our voices for the millions with COPD who can't. Learn more, breathe better at NIH.gov.
There are those who dedicate themselves to a sense of honor, to a life of courage, and a commitment to something greater than themselves. They have always defended this nation and each other. They still do. The few, the proud, the Marines.
Think fast. In less than 30 seconds, a small flame can become a big fire. Don't let your world go up in smoke. Have working smoke alarms and keep heaters 3 feet away from anything that can burn. Learn more at usfa.fema.gov because fire is everyone's fight.
Hi guys, Jim here from Shop Talk, inviting you to tune in every Saturday from noon to two right here on Superstation 101. We're gonna talk about your car, somebody else's car, maybe my car. Tune in every week right here, noon to two, on Superstation 101.
Four new tires and a tank of gas. And we're back to the fastest hour in radio on Superstation 101.
Welcome back in. Fastest hour in radio rolling on. As I mentioned, we're back at full strength after dealing with fun and weather and all the other kind of stuff. How are things coming in for you, John?
Doing good. Yeah.
Roads okay so far?
Yeah, they're a little wet. And yeah. The rain really picked up around Jasper coming in on 22. And it's heavy, heavy hit times.
You came in along 280.
Fog, pea soup, pretty much.
There we go.
Hello.
Yep, there we go.
I came in on 20.
We're playing musical microphones, by the way.
20 was good.
20 came, no problems?
No.
You didn't even have any rain when you came in?
Very little.
Very seems little like rain. Everything's moving west
only
to east.
Only
so.
The issue I had, there was an overturned truck on 2059 interchange ramp.
I hate it when that happens.
Yeah.
As I was coming in, of course, this was just after 5 o'clock. It was kind of going in from heavier to lighter to heavier to lighter to heavier to lighter rain. Pretty much all the way up from Alabaster. Joey, you came up 65 as well.
I did, yep.
Same thing, or has it gotten consistent?
Just rain, you know, right
yeah.
now.
Yeah, okay, but it's pretty consistent, steady, as
absolutely.
Opposed to up and down, and whether I turn on the intermittent or the full-time wipers. Joey, we're going to be talking with you full about all of your plans here coming up in just a minute, but now that we've got everybody in here, feel free to comment on any of these stories, and we're just going to kind of rifle through them here, and we'll spend a lot of time talking about plans. Matt's got some plans. You've got some plans. Plus, we got all the people that we're expecting to call in as well. And we're on Facebook Live.
Yes. Yes, we are. We're on Facebook Live. So Joey's joining us on Facebook Live. So we're going to be having some news out of him when we talk to him here in a little bit. I got one shout-out.
You do?
One shout-out this
Uno.
Morning. Very special shout-out. Goes up to my best friend, Nikki, and her fiance Dale on their son Jackson, who turned 2 years old yesterday. So big happy birthday shout out to my little buddy Jackson. Can't wait to see him this week. They're coming down.
I was about to say,
on Thursday.
Hearing they're on their way this way.
Yes, they are
with
on their way Thursday. A 2 year old, and I believe Delilah is 7 weeks old as of yesterday.
Nice.
Yeah, I'm gonna be praying for
they're moving to Alabama.
I'm gonna be praying for them on that trip with a 2 year old and a 7 month old.
They'll be good.
Whew.
It's amazing.
I can't even fathom that.
Yeah, so I just wanted to give a happy birthday shout-out to Jackson.
Understood.
Happy birthday, Jackson.
Absolutely,
right.
Jackson. Congratulations, and hopefully you'll have many, many more. When we left, we were talking about Camping World Truck Series. Parker Kligerman, who pretty much sat out almost all of last year, going to get another shot at NASCAR. He's going to drive in the Camping World Truck Series for Henderson Motorsports, going to pilot the number 75 truck for at least 8 races this coming year. Kligerman attempted to get that truck into Talladega last fall, but didn't qualify. Not much is known about the entry at this time, but Kligerman is not going to drive all the races for the team. They plan to enter a young gun by the name of Caleb Holman in a number of races as well. The entire slate of races not released. No word of a sponsor been mentioned at this time. And here's the thing. I don't even know whether it's a Ford, a Dodge, a Toyota, or a Chevy.
It's going to be one of the above.
Thank you.
Traditionally, it's been a Chevrolet, I believe, the 75 truck has.
Has it?
Yeah.
Yeah,
okay.
But I think it came out of Talladega as a Toyota, if I remember right.
That could change every week, too.
Yeah.
For Parker Kligerman, it'll be a Toyota. When it's Caleb Holman, it'll be a Chevy. We don't know. Hattori Racing has announced they've signed Ryan Truex to be their 2017 driver. Going to become a full-time operation as well. Hattori ran only 15 races last year with Truex behind the wheel. Now they're going to run all the events. Said that they have sponsorship from at least 10 companies. So instead of a round robin of drivers, it's a round robin of sponsors.
Hmm.
So if you've been looking for a sponsor, Hattori Racing probably got him. just be prepared. Charlotte Motor Speedway might be toying with the idea of creating a road course inside their 1.5-mile trioval configuration. About a week ago, A.J. Allmendinger performed a test on what became a 2.3-mile-long course that uses both the infield area of the track, turns 1 and 2 of the stock car course as we now know it. The course would, according to sources, possibly be used for the May All-Star race, but most people are actually saying it seems more likely it would come into play during the fall Chase race. Charlotte has heard fans are very interested in having a road course in the Chase and fewer 1.5-mile trioval setups. Charlotte could still host 2 races a year, give the fans their wish, one fewer cookie-cutter track and a road course event in the Chase. At this time, nothing is certain. I looked at the track. It's interesting. because it's the vast majority, quite frankly, of the 1.5-mile tri-oval. Just right after pit road, you dive down in the infield for this little turn, and then you come back out onto turns 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and all that.
Yeah.
You might be really good on the normal part, but then when it comes to road course, you might have a really bad car.
Oh, yeah, really. You seem giddy about this. Okay, Matt, you're not so certain here. Driver's perspective.
Bring it, Matt.
And we'll get your look at it here in just a second, Joey. Have you seen, by the way, the layout of how this looks?
I'm an iRacer, so I've actually driven the track lots of times, so it's not new to me.
All right, then I'm going to start with you then.
Would you like to see this
implemented in the stock car series?
Whatever they have to do for ratings, I guess. I mean, it's going to be interesting for sure. That's what we're looking for.
Would it make more sense for them to try it first in the All-Star race or just throw it out there and throw the drivers the curveball of saying, hey, listen, it's coming. It'll be in the fall in the chase race.
I think the All-Star needs some help, so that would definitely get me to the TV to see some carnage. That's what you have to think about.
And I guess that would become the other thing. I mean, you have to set up the car to be able to turn now right and left, but you also have to have the car be able to run. And what's the banking, 24 degrees at Charlotte?
20 or 24.
Somewhere between 20 and 24.
Yeah.
So you got to have it set up to be able to run the bankings of turns 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 as we know them now.
Yeah.
I mean, they'll be, I don't know, I want to say that all total they'll call it, I think, 14 turns if they implement the road course. Mm. But,
I would love, and I agree with the All-Star, I would love to see them just throw a huge knuckleball. I mean, today's word is knuckleball.
Sure, there you go.
A knuckleball, like...
If you're with us on Twitter, hashtag knuckleball.
Yeah, hashtag knuckleball. to really, really mess with the driver's psyche in the chase.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, put that thing in the chase.
Yeah.
Right after the figure eight track.
With the jump.
All right. Yeah, really. What are your concerns here? What are your major concerns here? What's your biggest problem with this idea?
I'm more with him.
Okay.
Put it in the All-Star race.
Just to try it first and see what happens.
Go exhibition first.
Just to try it and see.
Try it and see, and then if it works, hey, we're going to the chase with it.
Go for it.
If it stops Jimmy Johnson from winning at Charlotte, I am all for it.
Well, and I think that's the other – you and I have talked about this on the show on previous occasions. Hendrick Motorsports goes out there and they lock down a 1.5-mile tri-oval program out there because you got five of them in the chase.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, one less 1.5-mile tri-oval out there, and let's see if the 48 can handle it.
Yeah.
Let's see if anybody can handle it.
Your eyes twitching over there. Are you okay?
Yeah, I'm good. When I saw this come out, I had to double check. I checked so many avenues to make sure that I wasn't getting some crazy fake news site.
Oh, I thought about it too.
I went and Googled it and everything else, and I'm like, oh my gosh, this could be real.
Yeah.
I was like, they are listening to the show. All the griping that we do about a road course. So that's why
I never would have thought that they would have done it on the inside of an existing course, though. I was thinking they were going to go and grab another road course.
What I would have thought,
They've got Road America and Mid-Ohio and all these other tracks that they've got relationships with in other series within NASCAR. I figured that was how it was going to come about.
That's what we threw out a bunch of times was the road courses that we have previous, we already have.
Yeah.
Wasn't thinking about how they could kind of.
Certainly not at Charlotte.
Yeah.
But think about it. I mean, how many road courses can you go to, sit in the stands, and see the entire track? You're going to have that advantage at Charlotte. So, I mean, as a fan,
it is a good point. You're, great view.
You're going to have action all over the place. And I don't know that you want to put 43 cars on that track, but, that's going to be exciting. I'm already fired up.
All right. So let's go on the assumption that they put this in the All-Star race. It was a few years ago. I can't remember exactly when, but they had the rain that came down, and we had carnage on the first lap, and they allowed all those drivers to go back and grab their cars. If we had a massive wreck within the first five laps, do we now get the chance to do a redo and maybe grab all the other cars just to try and get as many of them in there throughout the course of the race?
I don't know about that.
I think you'd almost have to do that, wouldn't you? I mean, this is the first time.
Yeah, your hand is almost forced at that point.
Yeah, I mean, this is the first time you've ever been on that course, with all due respect to A.J. Allmendinger.
It depends on who wrecks. NASCAR will change that real quick.
That's probably true.
I like that.
Yeah.
That covered a lot.
Yeah.
But
yeah, you're probably right on that. If it's Chris Buescher that wrecks, no. If it's Jimmy Johnson that wrecks, yes.
Yeah.
Suarez.
Suarez. And then there's that conversation.
It was not fair. I want another try. Make him stop, Daddy.
Now, that's Joey Logano.
Well, that no, I think Suarez is going to be that kind of guy, too.
No, Suarez, he'll be going to... he'll be going to money bags.
Well, that's what I'm saying. You've got Joey going to daddy.
It'll be money bags.
Yeah, you might as well call it that.
Fox Sports 1's NASCAR-themed daily news race show, Race Hub, about to make its 2017 debut, and it's going to do so from the location of the Super Bowl, Houston, Texas. The week leading up to the NFL's championship game, hosts Danielle Trotta and Adam Alexander will be on the Fox Sports Super Bowl set. Guests will include Larry McReynolds, along with former driver-turned-Fox Sports commentator Jeff Gordon, 2016 Daytona 500 winner Denny Hamlin. Throughout the course of the week, on Monday, January the 23rd, the news magazine going to begin their 2017 preview, starting with the Chevrolet teams. Tuesday, they'll concentrate on the Toyota teams, and then they'll be back in Charlotte's studio on Wednesday before they go back live to Houston for Thursday and Friday and do a Ford preview show on Thursday of that week leading up to the Super Bowl. I'm happy to have Race Hub back. I got to admit, I miss it.
I
really enjoy the show.
I need Race Hub.
So looking forward to it, and then we'll have to see how this whole preview show thing goes, because there's been a lot of changes when it comes to that, obviously.
Yeah.
Including the guys that you and I root for. The man, sad news from our friends over at Talladega and Dustin and I's other boss, the man who helped Bill France build his vision of what became Talladega Super Speedway, has passed away. William Bill Moss was the co-founder of the Moss Thornton Company, a company that turned an area of land into the track that Dustin and I again work for two times a year. In the mid to late 1960s, Bill France was looking to build a super speedway that was the longest, steepest, and fastest track in the world, and wanted it built in Alabama. Found a plot of land about 40 miles east of Birmingham, 90 miles west of Atlanta, cut a deal with the government for the land in an area now known as Dry Valley. Once he got the land, he began to talk to Moss about his plans. Moss and his company turned the vision into reality. They actually had to create some machinery in some cases, and combined machines in other cases allowed them to build a 2.66-mile-long, 33-degree banked super speedway, allowing stock cars, not too long after that, to break the 200-mile-per-hour barrier. Broke ground on the track in May of 1968, went racing for the first time in September of 1969. You want to talk about totally changing the landscape in less than a year and a half time.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And the race was actually skipped by many of the stars of the day. They were concerned that the tires wouldn't hold up. France actually got behind the wheel of a car and drove it around there and looked at people like Richard Petty and said, "So there." That's a paraphrase, by the way.
Yeah.
That led France to enlist drivers from several other series to fill out the field, and it led to Richard Brickhouse's one win in what is now NASCAR's Cup Series. France also made an offer that is still almost, you think about it. How long have we been dealing with NASCAR? Almost 50 years at Talladega now, and it's almost still being taken up or at least asked about. He told fans that had a ticket for that very first Talladega race that if you didn't go to the first race and you kept the ticket, you could use it for any future Talladega race. Every once in a while, somebody calls up and goes, "Hey, I still got this ticket from 1969.
Really?
I have heard about that, yes.
Wow.
Yeah.
Mm. Yep. Moss also built another of France's visions, the International Motorsports Hall of Fame, which sits on the grounds at Talladega. He was the vice chairman of the hall for a quarter of a century following its opening in 1983. Bill Moss passed away last Saturday following the airing of this particular show a week ago. Bill Moss was 81 years old. Got a lot of recognition for doing a lot of stuff out there. Really good stuff.
Of course, we always remember him because they got the Moss Thornton Tower out there.
You can
see
the Moss Thornton Tower to this day.
Yes, you can.
So if you've ever wondered where that came from, now you know. Ever since NASCAR approved the return of top-tier racing to dirt, much has been made about whether or not the Cup Series could return to dirt track racing as well. Tony Stewart, who owns Eldora Speedway, the track that the Camping World Truck Series races on annually, feels as though he's got the perfect track for Cup to run on. He's talking about his own track, of course. He was interviewed by Fox Sports, quote, the Fox Sports little vignette, if you will, The Buzz, and host Daryl Mott recently. He was asked about whether Cup racing on the dirt could be coming. He said yes, if the fans bug NASCAR enough. Encourage those who want to see it to petition. NASCAR said, quote, "I'm all in favor of that. I know a perfect track in Ohio that'd be happy to host the event."
that track hosts maybe 25,000 people, and with all due respect to Eldora, it's not the easiest thing to get to.
Nope.
I'm not so certain that Eldora would be the place that NASCAR would go to for the Cup Series, at least on the first run.
For a Cup race, I see Knoxville, Iowa.
I keep hearing Knoxville, Iowa.
I see Knoxville, Iowa before Eldora.
Joey?
I think you keep them on asphalt and be done with it.
Yeah?
And you don't have that problem.
Well, then there's that way of looking at it. So you don't care whether they return to dirt at all.
No, I think the Truck Series, it's awesome what they've done with that. I think you're going to flood the market.
Mm-hmm.
I don't see any reason why you take the top tier guys and put them on dirt.
Would you mess with it in the Xfinity Series?
No.
No?
I would keep the Truck Series. I mean, I think that's going too far.
Something
with that.
That makes it something that separates out the Camping World Truck Series.
Absolutely.
It's got its little... You know, it surrounds, basically it just brings the Truck Series, gives them that shining moment. They're the only ones that race on dirt, so to speak.
Yeah.
I mean,
But I mean, we've seen the reaction. That's one of the hottest tickets going in NASCAR, and I don't care what of the top three series it is. People love to get that ticket to Eldora to watch that race.
Oh, yeah.
If we know NASCAR, they'll try and bury that. Stewart also got to talking about his plans for 2017. He did say during the interview Wednesday he had been in talks with teams about driving, for example, among his 70 to 80 races this year in both the Rolex 24 Hours of Daytona and the 24 Hours of Le Mans. But those deals, unfortunately, he said, did not come through as he was hoping they would. I mean, he was actually hoping that he was going to be able to do both of those. He's done the 24 Hours of Daytona before, and he's done well. Le Mans, man, that's a different monster.
I said, that's like two different beasts right there.
You're not kidding. Hey, he's a driver's driver, man. Yeah. As it is, Stewart says he is going to run about 80 races in all this coming year, mostly in sprint cars and late models, not to be confused with what we used to know as sprint cup, sprint cars and late models. Said he'd be happy to get behind the wheel of a sports car should the right opportunity come about. As for his ultimate schedule, Stewart said, quote, there's some on the schedule that would depend on where we are mid-season that might be big races that we're going to. Of course, he's talking about his role as the owner of Stewart Haas Racing. So time will tell, but we keep being told that he's going to appear at a certain short track over here about 40 miles west of the studios here in Berkeley.
Well, he was supposed to be.
He was supposed to be there if the ice bowl hadn't literally been iced out.
Yeah. Yep. Of course, that kind of scheduling conflicts and everything else going on, there's no way he can kind of be in two places at once. I would assume.
Probably not.
Of course, knowing him, it's hop on a flight, hop on a flight, hop on a flight, hop on a flight.
He's done that before, too. Yeah, no doubt about that.
I know.
So. And he was asked whether he might run or consider running at his own Eldora Speedway. He said, nope. The most I'm going to do about getting on the dirt is grooming the surface.
So, he's all about grooming that track.
Oh, yeah.
Making sure
he'll groom
good.
It, but he's not going to run on it.
And he's
pretty much
really good
it.
At it, too.
Oh, yeah. I mean, he's pretty much the guy that they like to do that out of the Chili Bowl. He was out there last weekend, as opposed to the Ice Bowl, helping to groom that course.
Yeah.
He likes that place. To the Verizon IndyCar Series, they've announced they've come to a long-term agreement with their tire supplier, Firestone. Terms of the new deal with the tire maker, Bridgestone America's tire operations not released, only termed as a multi-year deal. Firestone has been part of IndyCar for long enough that they can lay claim to being the winning tires on both the first and the 100th Indy 500 winners. In between, racers running Firestone tires have won 67 of the 100 races overall. It's been the lone tire provider to IndyCar since 2000. This season, as part of the new deal, Firestone's going to give teams more sets of tires for practice sessions. IndyCar officials are hoping it's going to mean more cars on the track for Friday practice sessions, which they hope will bring more fan interest to the courses. Time will tell.
Because everybody loves to watch practice.
Sure. The more cars you got out there, maybe.
It's like we saw a car a couple minutes ago. I think it's coming back out. Now you're going to have like a bunch out there doing it. I actually have something to watch.
Maybe so. Surprise winner of the 2016 Indy 500, the 100th running of that world-famous race, was Alexander Rossi, Rookie of the Year. He had a one-race deal with auto parts chain Napa, which turned into a five-race deal with them throughout the rest of 2016. Now he's going to be running full-time again in 2017 in the IndyCar Series, and Napa has announced they're going to return to sponsor him again for this year's running of the Indy 500. It's a multi-race deal for the pairing of the driver and the sponsor. Other races for the number 98, Alexander Rossi Andretti Autosports entry, going to be the season opener at St. Petersburg. When they go to Long Beach, they'll be at Road America, Watkins Glen, Sonoma, and state that another race or two might be possible. AJ Foyt Racing's confirmed they've completed their changeover. They're going to be running Chevrolet engines this coming 2017 season. Rumors began to circulate about that change not too long after the 2016 season ended. They were officially confirmed Tuesday of this past week, the same time and the same week that AJ Foyt celebrated his 82nd birthday. So happy birthday to AJ Foyt.
Yeah, they also put a nice little picture out too.
Yeah.
Yeah. On their AJ Foyt Racing Facebook page. We shared it on the Fastest Hour page.
Yeah, we did. It's a good look.
Yeah.
Going back.
Going back.
Well, I mean, not only was it the family, but there was also another picture out there that showed him in his heyday of winning Indy 500s and
that's
the dirt
right.
on his face and all that
yeah,
kind of stuff.
I saw
so
that one.
I've seen those pictures as well. It's good stuff. So for the two, you got two new Foyt Racing drivers, Connor Daly and Carlos Munoz, brand new start under the hood, so to speak. Foyt said of his return to Chevy, the make that he ran with when he last raced in the Indy 500 back in 1991, quote, "Glad to be back with Chevy. I've had a lot of success with him in the past. I'm looking forward to more success with him in the future." He's been a little bit frustrated here recently. There was an interview that he did, I think it was in the latest issue of Car and Driver magazine, where they do interviews with certain people in the back, and it's basically a what I'd do differently as they look back on it.
Yeah.
He said, "I wouldn't do anything differently about it," but he said he is ultimately frustrated right now because he's so used to winning, and he's such a bulldog when it comes to winning, that the fact that he hasn't really seen that success out of his own racing team's got him frustrated. So he's made a whole lot of changes. Two new drivers, Daly, Munoz, the switch over to Chevrolet. We'll see whether this works out for him.
Swinging for the fences.
Might as well.
Looking for something to happen.
Might as well.
Yep.
Ed Carpenter Racing has signed driver Spencer Pigot to come back to the team. Pigot's going to take the races that Carpenter himself doesn't run. Pigot ran last year on all the road and the street courses for the team in the number 20, his rookie year, and impressed Carpenter enough that he brought the 23-year-old back. Pigot's a 2015 Indy Lights champion, ran 10 races in all last year, and it wasn't full-time, I take that back. Split time between two teams, ECR Ed Carpenter Racing, and Ray Hall Letterman Lanigan. He drove the final 7 road and street courses for Ed Carpenter, claimed the 2 top 10 finishes, Mid-Ohio and Road America. Pigot said of his time, "I learned a lot in my rookie year, looking forward to the opportunity to build on that experience. I know I have the team around me to fight at the front, and that's what we'll be trying to do in 2017. As opposed to drivers that tend to come over, and we'll talk about that just in just a second, that they'll say, you know what, I'm interested in running IndyCar, but I only want to do the road and the street courses, because what you'll get is drivers who have attempted to get into Formula One, and that's all road courses,
right?
A couple of street courses. They don't want to run the ovals. Ed Carpenter is that guy that says, you know what, I'll do the ovals. I don't care. Matter of fact, I only want to run the ovals. So in this case, it works out really, really well, and it has. I mean, Ed Carpenter's winning races, and you get a rookie driver like Spencer Pigot who's going out there and running top tens. He may very well compete for some wins here this coming season as well.
Right.
So I find it a pretty interesting way of doing things. If you have to do this combination of drivers, that would be one way to go.
Yeah, definitely.
So we'll find out whether that works for him. KV Racing is attempting to find a way to remain on the IndyCar grid. Reportedly, they're talking to a former Formula One driver to take over their car. Motorsport.com reports KV Racing's been in talks with Pastor Maldonado. Yeah, we heard about him in Formula One. He didn't have the best of reputations in Formula One.
No, he did not.
Anyway, they want him to run a series of races similar to Spencer Pigot's schedule, which would be all the road and street courses. It's kind of a last-ditch effort, the team says, to keep their team alive. If it shouldn't work out, it has been reported that 2016 will have been KV Racing's last year in IndyCar, and that means Jimmy Vassar, former IndyCar driver himself, would be outside looking in IndyCar, effectively. That just seems weird to me.
Yeah, it'd be extremely weird.
Yeah,
big time. Not have a name like that that is actually well-known. I mean, I'm not exactly the biggest scholar of IndyCar, but I know that name.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's a very well-known name.
Yeah.
A lot of people don't put the two together, though.
True.
More times than not, they won't.
Yeah. Well, that's true. We talked recently about the desire of NASCAR to bring at least one more car maker into stock car racing. IndyCar officials kind of have the same in mind. Jay Fry, the director of competition for IndyCar, said the opportunity for a third engine maker is there. Of course, we just talked about it, Chevrolet and Honda. They've been the only two engine sources for IndyCar for 5 years, I think it is now. Before that, it was just Honda's pool to swim in for several years. Fry has begun what he's calling a 5-year plan for the series. He wants to give it pretty much an entire makeover by 2020. He's hoping to see a third, if not possibly a fourth, engine maker in there. The main reason is that it becomes a partnership between the series and the manufacturer, he says. IndyCar touts the competition between Chevy and Honda and whoever might else come in. course, the manufacturer touts their participation in the series as well. Says there's been some interest from varying makers, but he didn't say who, didn't give any kind of timetable for any other company to be welcomed in. Who else would come in? Ford would be the obvious one.
Yeah.
We keep talking about Dodge coming back to NASCAR. Would the Fiat Chrysler Automobile Corporation be interested in being an engine supplier for IndyCar?
Stranger things have happened.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I mean, that's all true. I got on that.
And then we stop and we think about all the Japanese makers. Obviously, we've heard Nissan as a possibility, Mazda, and so on and so forth. I mean, there's, I guess, a number of possibilities.
Mercedes has been in there before.
That's a long time ago.
That is a long time ago.
Yeah, they have. I don't know if Mercedes would be willing to do that and Formula One, though.
Yeah, true. That's a valid point.
That might not be the one that I would go to. What other European make would you go? I can't think of one right offhand. Jaguar's talking about FIA Formula E.
You can't say BMW. They're in Formula One, too.
Yeah, loosely.
Yeah.
And they're talking Formula E as well.
Yeah.
I can't think of a European maker that might do IndyCar, truth be told. It'd almost have to be either
Volkswagen.
Unless it was Fiat Chrysler, I can't think of a European base.
Yeah.
It'd probably end up being a Japanese make.
It's got to be.
I think
Japanese, they've got to do something because, I mean, if you look over to the NASCAR side of the house, you know, Toyota's having a heck of a heyday right now. And you think across all of racing, what do you hear most right now? You hear Toyota heard the most. So they've really got to step up somewhere.
Yep.
Of course, it's not going to be a NASCAR. So they got to go somewhere. And this would be a place for them, especially to get back in and really get their name back out there and maybe get it above Toyota being so worldwide known now.
We'll see.
Who's to say Hyundai wouldn't come in?
That'd be intriguing.
Yeah.
There's so many options.
There are. There are actually quite a few.
Get the Europeans. We're going way farther out now.
That's right. Musical chairs seem to be settling down here when it comes to Formula One. We've talked many, many times about Mercedes and what they're trying to do to replace the retired Nico Rosberg. We now know who it's going to be, and that created the domino effect of all the other seats being filled. We'll detail all that. We'll be talking with Joey Jatina. We'll be talking with Matt about their upcoming plans for 2017. Big stuff here. You've got a couple of events that are also involved with your plans, too. So really, really cool stuff. All of that and more coming up in the second hour of the Fastest Hour in Radio right here. Superstation 101 WIDE.
WIDE-FM Coleman. WIDE-AM Birmingham. W237-EK Birmingham. WDJC-HD2 Birmingham.
There's always a moment of truth where it's either put up or shut up. We were yelling our hearts out. Even in our weakness, even in our pain, we continued to push. I don't know where the pain went to, but all I know is that I had what it took. I am a United States Marine.
PFC Darrell Willis serves his country as a Marine. Will you? Visit Marines.com or call 1-800-MARINES.
This is State Health Officer Dr. Tom Miller. January is Cervical Health Awareness Month, and it's a great time to talk to your doctor if you haven't been screened for cervical cancer. Women aged 40 to 64 may qualify for free cervical cancer screenings if they have limited income and have no insurance or are underinsured. Also, the program now covers screening for women aged 30 to 64 who have had their tubes tied. For more information, visit our website at adph.org/early detection.
The biggest bottle that I could find would be gone within 20 minutes. And finally, my grandma comes up to me and says, "Hey, I think you need Teen Challenge. I'm no longer the person that I once was, and I'm now this new creation in God."
Hi, I'm Phil Joel. Freedom from addiction is possible. If you know a teen or an adult stuck in addiction, Teen Challenge can help. 1-855-END-ADDICTION or teenchallengeusa.com. Freedom from addiction starts here.
For too many parents, a baby's first steps aren't just a milestone. They're a miracle, made possible by volunteers like you who walk in March for Babies. The money you raise funds research and local programs that help babies overcome the challenges of premature birth and birth defects. Sign up today at marchforbabies.org to take the steps that help make milestones and even miracles possible for thousands of families. Who will you march for?
The Crohn's and Colitis Foundation of America invites you to take steps for cures at a walk near you. Support the 1.6 million Americans living with these diseases. Get started at cctakesteps.org.
A tornado watch has been issued through 11 a.m. for many of the southern counties across our area. Strong to severe thunderstorms with damaging winds and perhaps a few tornadoes expected through about 10 a.m. this morning. And then we'll see a little bit of a lull in the action for this afternoon. Temperatures climbing to about 70 degrees. Showers and thunderstorms are likely overnight tonight into Sunday morning. Some of those could be quite strong or severe. And then I think we'll see showers and storms at times through the day on Sunday with a high near 64. This is WBTM 13 meteorologist Stephanie Walker with the forecast on Superstation 101 WYDE.
Drivers and Danica, start your engines!
Pull those belts down tight one more time. Warm up those tires, hit your marks, and let's go racing, boys and girls. NASCAR, IndyCar, Formula One, Formula E, NHRA, and local dirt track and drag strip racing talk. This is the fastest hour in radio. Where'd you go? Here's your host, Steve West and Dustin Harmer, with producer John Myers.
Of course, you realize now, Dustin, we got to add to that, right?
Yes. I have to do all...
Oh, man. Sorry, man.
I've already started changing the social media and stuff, so the Twitter's updated. I gotta,
it's a long process.
Matt, it is. There's so many things to do.
We have to add in our new team member, Matt Nicholson, into that particular run there. And we're also joined in studio by one Joey Giattina. We'll be talking with him fully here in just a couple of minutes about his plans for 2017. Local driver right here in Alabama and hoping for really, really big things. What are you guys doing?
He was trying to say something.
You cut him off like three times.
Yeah.
All right, what do you want to say?
No, John, not me. No.
John.
John.
He's trying to get your attention.
Can I help you?
No, let's roll on.
put the hammer down.
I was just laughing at John.
Let's burn it, baby. Let's go.
Must have been really important.
I have no idea.
I don't know.
It's past now.
Are you in the conversation?
Absolutely not. I'm out of the draft.
Not an idea.
You been having a conversation with yourself over there? I mean, what? Seriously.
No, it's akin to, oh, I don't know, Stewart and what's her name?
Danica Patrick?
His favorite driver. So Stewart's way out front. That's where we are now. And
so we've left that way behind, huh?
It's way behind. It's in turn three in the wall.
I ain't got a clue.
So let's roll on.
Yeah, all that.
Okay, then. We are now into Formula One, and musical chairs is something that Formula One's been dealing with here for a while. One seat was finally confirmed, Mercedes, and they've been having quite a time trying to fill that seat alongside of Lewis Hamilton, three-time defending Manufacturers Cup-winning organization. They zeroed in quickly on Valtteri Bottas as their number one choice. And after weeks of rumor, innuendo, and talking with him and managers and so on and so forth, they finally confirmed he is signed, sealed, and delivered for 2017. So it'll be Valtteri Bottas and Lewis Hamilton at Mercedes. Deal made a bit smoother by the fact that Williams gets their power plants from Mercedes, so they had a working relationship between the two teams, and all that eased the process, they said. Williams was able to convince Felipe Massa to delay his planned retirement by at least 1 year, so he's going to be back with Williams as one of their two drivers for 2017. And all of this meant that Pascal Wehrlein was trying to figure out where he might end up, or would he just be out of a ride altogether. Last year, he drove for Manor Racing. Well, he's not going back to Manor, especially considering that they might not actually race in 2017. So he was just kind of a standby option should the deal with Bottas fall through at Mercedes. Bottas signs with the TriStar team. Wehrlein was snapped up by Sauber Racing. He'll join Marcus Ericsson for 2017 there. So now we've got 10 of the 11 organizations currently slated for the 2017 grid who have filled both of their seats. The lone exception, the aforementioned Manor Racing, who again
They may not be racing. They may not even be in existence much longer here. They've got 10 more days, according to the British government, to find the funding that they're going to need to be able to run in 2017, or else they're pretty much out of business.
Don't see that happening.
We haven't heard anything.
10 days flies by so fast.
Yeah, and we haven't heard anything here when it comes to that. You know, I went looking for anything I could find on Manor Racing and any talks with anything, and I heard nothing.
Yeah, there's about nothing it. Out
so
there.
I doubt seriously they're going to find anything in the next week and 3 days. And this is something that, as racers, both of you guys, you know about this. Right. You guys have been in the situation where you're trying to find sponsors that maybe not just getting you into a full season, but getting you from race to race. You know this situation. Now you're trying to fund an entire organization.
Yeah.
And one that costs, you know, $250 million to operate for a year.
Yeah.
10 days goes by fast.
Spoken from experience.
In a hurry.
Bernie Ecclestone recently sat down for an interview for a press association sport out of Europe. He said that at his age, 87 this coming October, he's not so certain how much of a future he's got in Formula One with the new controlling interest owner, American-based Liberty Media. Ecclestone's been with Formula One for 4 decades now, but he's not certain how his role might be defined or redefined under the new leadership. Ecclestone told a media outlet that he expects Liberty Media's takeover of the World Traveling Series to be finalized, quote, within 3 to 4 weeks. He then added, quote, we will have to see how we set the company up. It's not a case of my terms. It's a case of let's have a look and see which way they would go. It's something that would have happened anyway. We need to put something together if I'm not here because I've become deceased or something. And it is time that we did that. We're in the middle of that. And when we knew that these people were probably going to buy, we backed off, thought, well, let's wait and see, because they own the company and it's up to them to decide who they want or what they want. Now, upon buying controlling interest stake in the series, Liberty Media told Ecclestone they actually wanted him to stay on as their Formula One boss for 3 years. Said, quote, that's what they asked for. In fact, we are going to try to put together people that can look after all the things that I've been trying to find people do, sponsorship, things like that. As I said, let's see how we're going to separate. Wednesday of this week, World Motorsports Council, which includes the FIA's president, Jean Todt, and Ecclestone, they agreed to Liberty Media's purchase. That happened the day after the shareholders of Liberty Media approved the deal. Again, Ecclestone thinks this is all going to happen within 2 to 3 weeks. So, an American-based company owns Formula One, or at least the controlling stock in it. They're not going to. It's not going to be 50.1%, but of all the different stakeholders in there, Liberty Media would have the biggest stake. Stock. Stake in stock. Stock in stake.
Stake.
I find it interesting that we're dealing with this situation where an American-based company is finally owning Formula One. I don't know whether it means that America will actually get a bigger cut when it comes to Formula One. We've got this up-and-down relationship with that sport,
that particular series. Yeah, it's big.
So, I mean, I think it could only help, but at that point in time, again, we're starting to cut this little pie up into how many different slices now? We're getting some really small slivers here.
And I like my pieces of pie, you know, good size.
I like a big piece too.
I don't think I'd be dealing with,
especially
like,
right after steak,
a sliver. Ooh, pumpkin pie.
Peanut butter.
No, and I mean, I like the fact that an American-based company would have a lot of, you know, control over it, but I don't see it really affecting. I don't see it helping.
And how much
the
longer,
American cause.
With all due respect, how much longer can Bernie Ecclestone do this? He turns 87 in October. If he stays for 3 years, the man's going to be 90 before his 3-year deal runs out. Can he really handle the world traveling that it would take at the age of 90?
Can we just put him in one of those escape rooms that we know he'll never get out of and just leave him there just for good? As long as he's got food, he's good. No phone, TV.
You want him out. You want him gone?
I'm so tired of Bernie Ecclestone.
Is it that he's just... Are you tired of talking about him, or are you tired of what he's done?
I'm just tired of what he's done. I mean, I think he's just... The man ain't right.
I second that.
He's not. I mean...
Time for new control.
Exactly. We've talked
time
about
to start
it so many different
person.
Times. He's kind of... You know, we've got the same thing happening on the NASCAR side of the house. You know, they're starting to lose their minds when they make some decisions.
Starting to?
They're following... Well...
Wait till Monday.
You got to.
Yeah, really.
10 days. Give them 10 days. I mean, right now, they're on par to turn into Bernie Ecclestone, so to speak.
Yeah.
So,
well,
I mean,
See, I know where he's going with the wait 2 days, because guess what? NASCAR Media Day starts on Monday, and that's when they start announce all those big changes.
Good point.
Heat races and all that wonderful running backwards around the racetrack and whatever they can come up with, I guess.
Hey, Demolition Derby.
Yeah.
Road courses in reverse, in the Chase, Daytona, and all that.
Are you anticipating anything huge coming down the pike?
I think that what I'm hearing is the timed events are going to, the road courses, I believe, are going to be timed events, which that's fine. I mean,
I mean, Formula One technically does it. They'll try and get a set lap in, but if they can't get all those laps in, if 2 hours comes before you get all the laps in, race is over.
Yeah. It's kind of what they did with Supercross. They changed it up a little bit when Monster came in, so... Mm-hmm. They're talking about doing that with NASCAR, and then, of course, they're talking about heat races, and then we've all seen some of the stuff on social media with double point races and stuff. So who knows? I mean, we won't know until Monday.
We saw that crazy graphic come out we were talking about on the show. That'd be so wild.
Scary.
I mean, there's a lot of, crazy. No doubt. There's a lot of stuff out there that would make all these, you know, changes somewhat intriguing for a little while, but in the end, aren't they just Band-Aids over deep, deep cuts?
Absolutely. And, I we've heard so many excuses, and we all continue to let them have those excuses, but I think it honestly comes down to one thing and one thing only. You look out at the parking lot, we used to come in the 90s, and there was... trailer after trailer of souvenir, you know, each driver, and they're gone now.
Yeah,
does that tell you what's going on in the sport? It's not the racing.
It's not the performance superstore now.
It's the drivers cannot manage. The fans are not behind their drivers. In the 90s, I mean, you would have lines outside those trailers for Mark Martin, Terry Labonte. You got on the list: Earnhardt, Rusty Wallace, Darrell Waltrip. These guys can't even keep the merchandise trailers on the track now. Yep. I mean, they're throwing everything under one tent. So I think your problem with NASCAR is that's your problem. It's not the price of tickets. Yeah. And
we've talked about some things. The price of tickets is something that some people have complained about, obviously, as you start to get into some pretty high dollar areas when it comes to certain tickets, especially near a start finish line.
Yeah.
But I tend to agree it's not as much that. We've had our own particular comments about it, and most of us here on this show have kind of come to the idea that we don't have anything to root for when it comes to looking at the car on the track. At least the front end of the car has a basic look of a Camry or a Chevrolet SS, at least for this year, or a Ford Fusion, but the rest of the car doesn't look anything like what you're going to buy when you go to the dealership there. And it used to be not only did you have the package deal of the driver, you also had the package deal of the driver and the car. Because you could go down, and if you were a Richard Petty fan in the late 1960s or early 1970s, and you saw him drive a Plymouth, you could go down and you could buy that same Plymouth, with all due respect, not necessarily all decked out for racing, but it was the same looking car.
Yep.
And for all intents and purposes, it was the same engine under the hood. You know, or if it was... If you were a Chevrolet fan and you liked Bobby Allison when he was driving the old Monte Carlo in 1972, '73, you could go down to a Chevy dealership and buy a Monte Carlo that looked like the Monte Carlo that Bobby Allison drove. Mm-hmm. Nowadays, you can't.
Mm-mm. And I agree with that. I think everybody's got their own opinions of what's wrong. When I was growing up as a child, fell in love with the sport, you know, this guy's became your family.
Yeah.
You know, I didn't so much care about going and buy a car on Monday parts. Still don't. Mm-hmm. I don't care what the model looks like. It's off the track for me. It's the personalities. They are coming back to that, though. I mean, I don't think it gets any better than the Lumina and the you know, that was the best looking stocker I think ever. But I just think that, you know, you talk about Davey Allison, Bobby Allison, man, we've had some great guys in the sport, and the foundation that they laid and the work that they did was just amazing, and we're not even close to that these days.
So it's more for you an accessibility to the drivers.
I don't care. I mean, it's not the meeting part. It's just who those guys were.
Yeah.
They loved what they did. They busted their tail to get there. You know, you've heard the stories of Rusty eating bologna sandwiches out of the back of a U-Haul.
Right.
Mark Martin multiple times trying to get in the sport. Now, I mean, you know, here's the problem. You can go out, and if you wrote me a check right now, I could call Charlotte, North Carolina, and they have a plane waiting on me down here in Birmingham. That's how you make it in the sport today.
Right.
So we talk about a disconnect from manufacturer standpoints, but the disconnect for me, and I think a lot of fans, we're not dumb. We know what it takes to get to the sport now. The disconnect is these guys aren't working their way to that level. Mm-hmm. Majority, 90%, I'd say, of the drivers today are not earning their spot where they're at. It's their father. It's their whatever that puts them in that position. And that's where
billionaire countrymen.
That's where the respect level is gone, and that's why I think you see these souvenir trailers gone. That's why the fans are not supporting these drivers anymore. I mean, Stewart's gone. I mean, we're running out of drivers. Soon it's going to be a 21, 23-year-old drivers out
right.
there. And
that's my situation right now. With Tony Stewart gone, when I grew up, I became a fan of Darrell Walter. You know, and of course that was a little bit on the controversial side here in an area where he and Bobby Allison were so much the big enemies, if you will. I mean, such massive competitors against each other. They had a massive dislike of each other. But I grew up a Darrell Walter fan either way, and when Darrell started to get to the point where he was ready to retire, I'm like, okay, I need to find a new driver. And it just so happened that the night that I tuned in to the 1999 Richmond race, it happened to be Tony Stewart that won the race, and I found out he drove for Joe Gibbs Racing. Well, I'd had the chance to meet, fleetingly, Joe Gibbs right after his last Super Bowl win with the Washington Redskins. And you want to talk about a class guy, just having the chance to talk to him for a couple of minutes, 100% class guy. And I went, oh, he drives for Joe Gibbs? There's my guy. Now Tony Stewart's gone. I'll root for the team Stewart Haas Racing to do well. I don't know as I'm going to pick a driver now.
It's hard. I don't know. You might could help me as far as like who's left that actually came up. Like Carl Edwards is the last guy, to my knowledge, that actually came up through the sport the hardest way possible, and that was having to earn it.
Yeah.
Who else is left?
I mean, Clint Boyer. Been pushed out.
Clint Boyer, absolutely. That if anybody thinks he retired because he's tired or he's
That was
NASCAR's big money, right? That was racing in general, big money taking control of that situation.
Right.
He'll be back, Dodge, hopefully.
Yeah,
well, that's what we're hoping for.
That's what we said.
That's what we're hoping for as well.
Boyer.
Joey's on board.
I was trying to think. Jimmy Johnson came up through motorbikes in California.
Kyle Larson. Yeah, he had plenty of opportunities.
Kyle Larson. He came up through dirt.
Kyle Larson came up through sprint cars.
Kyle's situation, he didn't have Kyle really had to work hard to get
Kyle
where he's
did,
at.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Kyle did.
So.
Yeah.
Let me see. The Bush brothers were Vegas guys.
Kurt and Kyle, yeah.
I'm trying. It's the funny thing is that other than Kyle Larson, with all due respect, we're talking about the guys that are, well, probably getting ready to step out in the next few years. You think about the Matt Kenseths, and you know, I don't know specifically about all of their backgrounds. By
my
and large,
guy's not too far out,
you know. But you look at, you know, we talk about the Bush brothers. You talk about Harvick. You talk about Kenseth. You talk about Edwards. Who, yeah, he'll be back, but he's 37. He'll be 38 by the time he comes back.
Yeah.
Who else? Ryan Newman. Those guys who worked their way up and had to bust through and, you know, maybe try and get one or two shots at it. I mean, Ryan Newman was, what was it back then? I guess it was still Bush at the later part of that when he became a champion back then and had to fight his way into NASCAR and finally got in with Roush Fenway. Those guys are pretty much gone. Now you got the Joey Logano's of the world. You got the Daniel Suarez's of the world. Thank you very much, Carlos Slim out of Mexico.
Yeah.
You know, most of the younger drivers that are out there right now, these are the people that pretty much had everything given to them. Yep. They didn't have to work that hard for it.
For me, I mean, if I was a driver, like, you know, the ones you've mentioned, you know, Harvick, the Bush brothers and
Greg
stuff
Biffle.
Like that. You know, Greg Biffle, there's another one.
Who's, by the way, without a ride right now.
But now you've got these kids showing up with these checks from daddy. I want to drive in NASCAR. And they go, well, here you go.
Yeah, and we just got done with Formula One talking about that. Effectively, Formula One now, if you don't have a sponsor that comes with you, they're not going to give you that seat.
Yeah. Yeah.
It, motorsports in general is just in bad shape. And
it's become all about the money instead of about
it's the only sport,
racing.
It's the only sport you can become a professional with a stroke of a pen.
Yeah.
Yeah. Unfortunately.
It's no longer about talent. It's about how much money you've got, you can find, or you can bring.
And speaking of that, to the NHRA, where Don Schumacher Racing has announced they've garaged the Sean Langdon entry. They cited a lack of proper sponsorship. The team owner confirmed that the dragster is going to be sitting idle. Said, while it's unfortunate, his most recent driver addition, which is Langdon, is the victim of that sponsorship reduction. Langdon joined the team in late 2015 when Alan Johnson Racing ceased operations. When he was contacted, said he was disappointed, but he understood why. Quote, it's the hardest thing about our sport, no question about it. Going from something that I experienced back with Alan when we lost our funding over there, you come over here to Don's team and then go through it again. So I hate it. And he says he's seeking out possible sponsorship partners to get back on the track sooner rather than later. Schumacher said that he told media he hopes to run the car again as well. Quote, I'm working on some things that'll hopefully work out. Give me the funding to get the car on as soon as possible. The days of self-funding are pretty much done.
Yeah.
Inflation.
Yeah. it gets too expensive.
Prices, I mean, everything's skyrocketing.
I mean, of all the series that we cover, by and large, what we're dealing with as far as the cheapest one is IndyCar, and that's $3 to $5 million a year. Mm-hmm. To run a full-time NASCAR Cup Series team is 20 to 25, easy.
Yeah.
We already talked about it. $200-$250 million to run a Formula One team. It's not cheap to run NHR either. Probably, what, 10 mil easy?
Yeah.
I haven't looked up that price, but it's got to be somewhere in
that area. I mean, all the rebuilding of the engines that you have to do after every run.
Let's talk to the man, late model Mark, out there. You know a little bit more, you know more about the NHRA than we do. About how much is it to put a Mellow Yellow Series drag racing team out there, operate for a full year? 10 mil?
$4.5 million.
Okay, so it's cheaper than what I thought.
Yes. $4.5 million to $5 million. I got a lot to say this morning.
So it's on par with IndyCar, effectively.
Yeah. I mean, Nitro, you're just burning liquid $100 bills when you see that stuff coming out of 8-pipe. It is a pricey endeavor.
Sure.
For sure. But
yeah, but on the grand scheme of things, it's not as expensive as I thought. I thought it was about twice that amount, truth be told.
No, it is not. It's just anywhere from $4 to $5 million. That's what it pretty much cost the Don Schumacher Racing and John Force Racing. About that to put a car on the track for the 24 race series.
It's still a hefty investment, though.
Mm-hmm. Yes, for sure. Let me get away with some sad stuff real quick, and then I got a comment and then a few other things. We had some passings here this week, and I'm not going to any particular order. Two of them are my favorite, some of my favorite racers, and one of them was a great guy, in my opinion. First, I'd like to say rest in peace to the Iowa driver Vern Motes. He was a multi-time Division 5 top alcohol funny car champion, national champion, and world champion. He was a great race car driver before his retirement. We lost him on Monday. One that really gets to me because I saw him on day one. He was one of the threesome of the famous, most famous funny car of all time, the Chi-Town Hustler, Farkonis, Coyle, and Minnick. Pat Minnick died Wednesday at age 79. And the Chi-Town Hustler was a funny car that you book him against another funny car and you could draw 10 or 15,000 people to a track to see that one car, which is just unheard of in auto racing then and now. And I got to see Pat Minnick drive the Chi-Town Hustler in its Southern California debate in 1969 in the month of November. They did three consecutive weekends at Orange County, Lions Drag Strip, and Irwindale Hill Raceway, the three sold-out crowds in a row, which is kind of unheard of. So rest in peace to Pat Minnick of the famous Chi-Town Hustler. The third person we lost just a couple of days ago, he was a 20-year veteran of the Tuscumbia Police Department, a Purple Heart recipient of the Vietnam War, and he saved the Moulton Speedway. Wayne Burns passed away this week.
Oh, wow.
Like I say, rest in peace to his wife, Carol. Wayne and Carol hired me for about five or six shows over the years. And he was a former track operator at Thunder Hill up in Tennessee and took over Moulton when nobody wanted to take it over, even though it was a success, and he kept it going. So rest in peace to Wayne on that one.
Yeah. Wow. I didn't realize that he had passed away.
Yes.
As a matter of fact, you mentioned Pat Minnick. We were just about to mention him and the Chi-Town Hustlers and him going up against guys like Gary Dyer, who brought about Mr. Norm's Grand Spalding Dodge entries and things like that. It's kind of a classic time in the NHRA.
Yes, it was. It was, in my opinion, the best time. As a matter of fact, you mentioned Gary Dyer. In November of 1963, my father took me to see Gary Dyer and Mr. Norm's Grand Spalding Dodge versus Donald Roy J's Infiniti GTO. 14,000 people showed up, and there hadn't been a funny car out of the nine-second zone, and Gary Dyer popped off an 863, which was an unbelievable run, maybe one of the best runs in NHRA history. And that was indeed a fantastic car. I'm not sure who your guest is, but I have to take issue with his comment that motor racing is hurting in general. I completely disagree with that assessment, and I'll give you a couple of examples of success stories. The Lucas Oil Late Model Series, the United States Modified Touring Series, the World of Outlaw Late Models and the World of Outlaw Sprints, the DIRT Big Block and Small Block Modified Programs, and also the USAC Series, and the USAC Midget Series are all doing well, and NHRA is not doing too shabby. So to say in general, maybe it's just a matter of wording, but I disagree completely with your guest on that one. When there's a lot of success stories, sure, there's some short tracks that are not doing well, and maybe some other series that are not done, knocking it out of the park. But we got about 8 or 9 series in this country that are kicking ass, in demand, and they can't fill all the requested dates. So that's why I disagree with your guest on that one. Okay. Respectfully, of course.
Gotcha.
And quick thing before I know we're coming up to the break, and I'm heading to my next store. A couple of stats on Saturday, which you boys were there for the Ice Bowl.
Loved it, by
the way. Do you know that we hot-lapped 309 cars on Saturday, qualified 101 late models, ran 34 heat races on Saturday? That is a lot of racing for a $20 bill.
Not
then
bad at
Sunday,
all.
Sunday, 17 B-mains, 8 feature events. Still a good deal for your $20 ticket. And that, sir, with 334 race cars, is a success story at Talladega Short Track. We're pleased. We're so glad that we had you there. It was really cool. And Dustin, them sunglasses certainly came in handy, and he should tell you about that off the air on Sunday. That was quite comical, to say the least. But
were you wearing the sunglasses at night in Victory Lane when you went to the infield?
I didn't go to the infield.
You didn't go to the infield?
No, I. You know what? I told Mark that I decided no. I told him decided I was going to wait for Steve.
He did. I will vouch for that. He did say that.
I don't get the sunglasses.
Yeah, he did. Yeah, he did. Yeah, there was one other thing. The pay-per-view was a pretty successful endeavor. And, you know, at, when you have 334 race cars and a fantastic crowd we have over the weekend, we're just pleased to start off our short track season over there at Talladega. We're going to get going late March. We're going to have a lot of good events coming up. And as the schedule comes out, I'll give you guys some tips. But it was a lot of fun, and glad to have you guys there. And both, Dustin, you know when you go to a race, you wear a racing shirt, not football, a racing shirt. Remember that.
Whoa, racing, whoa. Steve did the same thing Saturday, so throw him under the bus, too.
Racing shirt, Dustin. No excuse for you.
My Cowboys were doing good, and then Green Bay showed up.
You know what I found? You might have skipped up, but one of the dudes who was doing the pay-per-view was talking about football, and I had to say, we're at a racetrack. We're not worried about the Packers and the Cowboys.
Wesley.
Yeah, I got you.
Yeah, but anyways, boys, I got to roll. Keep up the good work, and rock and roll.
We'll do it. Thank you. Bye-bye. Late model Mark from Talladega Short Track. Great time. We'll kind of go some details on that.
Real quick.
We'll finish up everything, and then we'll be talking with Joey and Matt totally for the last half hour of the fastest hour in radio. Stay close.
You're listening to the fastest hour in radio on Superstation 101.
If you've heard of radon, you might think that it sounds like something out of a sci-fi movie. But did you know that the colorless, odorless, and tasteless radioactive gas could pose a serious health risk to the air in your home? This is State Health Officer Dr. Tom Miller. Radon gas is produced by the breakdown of uranium in soil, rock, and water. It is harmlessly dispersed in outdoor air, but when trapped in buildings, can increase the risk of lung cancer, especially at elevated levels. More than 20,000 Americans die of radon-related lung cancer every year. Exposure to radon gas is the second leading cause of lung cancer, next to smoking, and the number one cause of lung cancer among non-smokers. You can't see radon, but it's not hard to find out if you have a radon problem in your home. Visit our website at adph.org/radon for more information and to request a free radon testing kit for your home.
This message brought to you by the Alabama Department of Public Health and this station.
There's something very dangerous in your home. It could be hiding in a closet or waiting in the basement. It's not sharp or toxic or flammable, yet it helps send more people to the trauma center than any other household item.
Hey, hon, do me a favor and hold the ladder for me.
I have a better idea. Let's just call somebody to clean the gutters.
To scoop out a few leaves? I'll be down in a heartbeat. Whoa! Ow!
No!
Using a ladder might seem easy. Misusing one is even easier. Ask any of the 150,000 people who fell off their ladders into the trauma center last year alone. Don't let a do-it-yourself project do yourself in. For tips on ladder safety, visit orthoinfo.org, a public service message from the American Academy of Orthopedic Surgeons, who want to keep your bones safe, strong, and well-connected.
Okay, here are three important reasons why your son or daughter should play a sport in high school.
Number one.
High school sports teach valuable life lessons like self-discipline and time management skills.
2.
Teens who play a high school sport have better grade point averages.
And 3.
High school sports are safer than ever before.
This message presented by the Alabama High School Athletic Association and the Alabama High School Athletic Directors and Coaches Association.
Saturday mornings at Superstation 101, great lineup of live and local talk for you, and included in that is the Entertainment Roundtable. I'm Steve West, along with Jeff and Jacob and Ryan, myself, John Myers, Dustin Harmer is going to be in there as well. We're going to talk about movies, we're going to talk about television, we're going to tell you what you want to see, what you don't want to see. It's all on the Entertainment Roundtable, Saturday mornings, 10 a.m. and only on Superstation 101 WIDE.
Back to Green Flag action on the fastest hour in radio. Superstation 101.
Back into it, final half hour or so of this week's fastest hour in radio. And one more note here, NHRA Fox Sports announcing their television plans for the Mellow Yellow Drag Racing Series this 2017 season. As opposed to all of the finals being live last year, this time 16 of the 24 final shows will be live. 4 of them will be on the Fox Network. Last year marked the very first time ever that the NHRA had aired live on broadcast television, having only aired on cable networks previously. The finals airing on the Fox Network will be the season opening Circle K NHRA Nationals from Pomona, California. The other 3 Sunday Fox finals will be the Mile High Nationals from Denver, Northwest Nationals in Seattle, Chevy Performance U.S. Nationals from Indianapolis. Fox Sports 1 will have the other 12 live finals performances, including all 6 of the NHRA Mellow Yellow Countdown to the Championship events, the NHRA Playoff events, and the Auto Club NHRA Finals that will also be in Pomona, California to end the season. The remaining 4 events on the 2017 calendar will be showed on a delayed basis. I looked at that. Those will start at about 6 o'clock or so Eastern time, according to what I can tell by and large. So it's not going to be a big delay. I mean, ESPN used to put them like midnight.
Yeah.
So yeah, they're just delaying them later on into the evening. But that relationship appears to still be a very, very cool thing for the NHRA and Fox. And it's not hurting them when it comes to being in the stands as well.
Yeah.
So we're looking forward to that. Okay. And then we got Dirt Report.
That's right. Dirt Report. Start off with the 26th annual Ice Bowl at Talladega Short Track. Just going to go over the feature winners. Top 3. We're only going to mention the top 3. Sportsman feature. We had the winner was Ruben Mayfield. Second was Todd Hernandez. And third went to Johnny Riddings.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Yes. There we go. See.
Johnny Riddings.
Make sure we got the name.
Make sure we got that's why we got Matt here. Super late feature winner Michael Page, and he took off, and that was about it for that. Second went to Donald McIntosh. Coming in third was Jason Height. That was my guy that I picked. So Jason, you got to get it. 2 more spots next time, buddy. Thundercar feature winner Booger Brooks. Second place went great to name. Kenny Taylor, and third was Eric Smith. Now this was the interesting one. This one, we got to share the video. Crate Late feature winner was Brandon Williams. Second place was Riley Hickman. Get back to him in just a second. Third place went to Ronnie Johnson. And the interesting note about Riley Hickman, he finished second in reverse because he had a little lazy spin out there coming off of 4. But they were so far out in front of the field, he was able to basically back it across the line down the entire front stretch from 4 all the way across
the
line.
A little unusual. It's not the way that most people do it. But, hey, if it works, it works.
It was awesome to watch that, though, because we'll have to share that. We'll have to get that video on the Facebook page. Crate Sportsman feature. We had the winner was Booger Brooks. Second place went to Michael Page. And third went to my choice, Anna Parkhurst. So she finished in third place there. Neesmith Street Stocks, the feature was won by Trevor Woodard. Second place went to Johnny Stokes, and third went to Wyatt Hill. The Hot Shot main feature, there was 2 features that they had. Hot Shot main feature, winner was Roger Wood. Second went to Jonathan Merritt Sr., and third went to Chris Frost. And the Hot Shot non-qualifier feature was won by Nathan Adams. Second place was Terry Merritt, and third was Jamie Browning. Only other part of the Dirt Report that we've got out of Tulsa, Oklahoma for the Lucas Oil Chili Bowl Nationals presented by General Tire. Steve, one quick question for you. Who was the first Oklahoman winner of the Chili Bowl, and do you remember when it was?
Absolutely not.
Don't remember? Don't you look over here, Matt, trying to cheat. You
no,
know?
I don't actually.
Okay, it was 1994, Andy Hillenburg.
Oh.
So fast forward to this year, as the 23-year-old Oklahoman by the name of Christopher Bell, we're hearing his name a lot more.
Absolutely.
He found victory lane for his team, Keith Coon Motorsports, with the win by Bell. That puts Keith Coon with 6 overall Chili Bowl titles for an owner since the aforementioned 1994, when Hillenburg won in his Keith and Rusty Coon's owned entry. Rounding out the top 3 were Darren Pittman and Justin Grant. And a little side note for you, Rico Abreu, 2-time Chili Bowl champion 2015 and 2016, started dead last, 26th in the field, made it all the way up to finish 11th, but he couldn't get any more than that. And that's the dirt report. It's so nice to actually have a dirt report. So there it is. We got more coming at you.
Yeah, and it feels good to actually be able to now get back into it.
Yes, because I actually
and
have
talk about racing results.
Yes,
it's really cool
results.
Stuff.
I'm pumped up now.
last year, when we were out at Talladega, Joey, you were in the ARCA Series event.
Yes, sir.
Is this something we're trying to do more of?
No, I don't think so. No,
okay.
We're looking at just getting back. We got lucky to do a truck start a couple years ago with Norm Benning. Not much to really brag about there. I have a record of my own in NASCAR. Debut race and didn't get a single lap under green. So, but hey, you gotta have a record somewhere, right? So
you have a record. You have more than I have.
Yeah, yeah. So it was great. We had just lost our funding. Well, we actually had our money stolen. Week before Talladega, and then we were asked to come do that to kind of make up for it because they felt sorry for me. So, but it was a great experience. But that's where our game plan is to focus on the trucks this year again at Gateway.
Okay.
So. Okay. Nice. Very cool. Like that. With that said, I want to bring in our two ARCA series gentlemen, Mark and Rowdy, coming in. And let's see. Mark, you were out at the Chili Bowl, so you happened to see all of the action that was out there.
There was a lot of action. There's actually probably more racing at the Ice Bowl count-wise, but we went through almost 30 races on Saturday, and those transfer spots, that's all you had to watch from the race to race was who's going to try to transfer. Most incredible, intense racing I've seen in a long time.
Very cool. And you were out with us, Rowdy, out at Talladega. What'd you think about everything out there?
Man, I'm going to tell you what, I'm sold in dirt right now. Those super late models, they were absolutely awesome.
I love it. That's good stuff. All right, so plans real quick as far as we look back last weekend, kind of an overview of what you know when it comes to ARCA Series testing out there. How did things look?
Well, overall, you know, there was a couple of big stories that developed. One of our guests, Willie Mullins, is going to be back on this weekend. His fastest time was 11. Everything went great with the composite body. There was nothing but rave reviews on how they handled and the package deal that they put together. And of course, that deal's going to happen at Daytona and Talladega in 2018. But you've got to work now. So now we're just gearing up for the 54th annual Lucas Oil Engine Treatment 200 driven by General Tire. And that's, guys, hey, 27 days away and actually 3 Saturdays till race day.
I love it. That's good stuff right there. All right, real quick, and we're going to talk about this a little bit more as we go along here, but teams and drivers that you guys are looking forward to when it comes to kind of stepping out and making their name here in 2017. Mark, who are you looking at?
Oh, you know, you have your Venturis, you have your Cunningham. They all run good. I have my eye on the Wintron racing team owned by Kevin Sawinski. And car number 32 and Gus Dean is driving for them. He finished 10th last week in practice. I just have a feeling he's going to make some noise this year.
Okay. Rowdy, where are you looking?
Well, you know, with that new Elmore engine, with all the first-time winners, Harrison Burton is going to be doing some selective racing. So I kind of look for Harrison to come step up and maybe grab a checker flag there. Shane Lee.
All right. So those are the guys that we're kind of be thinking of, and we'll talk about some more drivers and teams to watch out for as we get closer to it. Again, three Saturdays away.
Yes.
And we actually get to watch racing, and that's going to be – is that live Fox Sports 1, or do we know yet who's televising Daytona?
Well, I'm sure it's going to be – I'm almost 100% sure it's Fox 1, but they have not announced the TV packages yet. We should expect that this week, I would think, would be coming out.
All right. Well, good. We'll have some good news next week, hopefully, then. Very cool. All right, guys. What's the plans here over the next couple of weeks? You just waiting on the ARCA Racing Series to start, or are we going to be, Mark, heading someplace in particular here between now and then?
Well, I'd like to head down to Georgia for the Speed Fest for the ARCA CRA Series, but I don't know if that'll happen or not. Yeah, it may be Daytona before anything kicks up for me again.
Okay, Rowdy?
I'm kind of like Mark. If I can manage a way to get to the one that was Speed Week at the Watermelon, where they hold the Watermelon Festival, I think that's going to be a great show. But I'm going to tell you guys, those super late models on dirt, those last show at Talladega, the short track, was absolutely awesome. I'm still dirty from it.
There you go. I love it. Well, we're looking forward to seeing you guys again when it comes to Talladega, both NASCAR and Talladega Short Track Weekend, so we can all get back together then, and maybe I'll just get over there and watch some great dirt track racing over there that night.
Looking forward to it as always, guys. Enjoyed meeting up with you.
Absolutely. We enjoyed meeting you guys, and we appreciate you guys coming on with us each week, giving us a little bit of an update on ARCA, and we'll do it again next week, okay?
Appreciate it.
You got it.
Thanks, guys. Appreciate it so much. Don't forget, you can check out their show. We've got our link to it on the Fastest Hour in Radio.
I'll throw it back up again.
Yep, and we'll give you the link to their Monday evening show, so make sure that you check that out. All right, Matt, I'm going to start with you because we're going to go real quick because you're a regular part of the show, so you can update us week to week.
Right.
But last weekend, Ice Bowl,
yeah,
you started to feel that urge to get back behind the wheel.
Yeah. Great Facebook post after that was over with.
I know. I was like, come on!
Yeah. I've got to say, and it's like, oh, well, not essentially a cowboy, maybe somebody to rodeo. You don't go to a horse show without your horse.
Yeah.
I went to a horse show without my horse.
So now you're looking forward to bringing the horse back. How much work do you need to do?
Mine is essentially ready to go.
Okay. So you'd be ready to
go through, through a few standard general maintenance procedures that I always go through standard week to week. But other than that, hook it to the truck and let's go.
I was under the impression by what you had said that you're pretty much going to try and stay fairly close to home. You might do some excursions to some tracks, but Talladega Short Track is what you're going to concentrate
on. That's going to be home base. But I may venture out to a track in Mississippi or Georgia here and there, but Talladega is going to be mainly home base for the year.
So you're looking to race pretty much the whole year?
That's the plan as of right now, unless something disastrous happens. That's the plan as of right
disasters,
now.
No disasters, no disasters.
No.
Speaking of wanting no disasters, love the fact that we got to see your car out there during the ARCA Series race last year. We want to see more out of Joey Jatina, Birmingham area driver, and we want to see more out of you. So what is the plan here? What is the on-track plan first, and then we'll talk about the off-track stuff.
Right now the on-track plan is Gateway, June.
Okay.
I think it's 19th. So we're going to go there. We're working with NASCAR. The biggest thing this year for us, we didn't get to race a lot. So what the goal is I want to run a NASCAR-sanctioned event this year at the Talladega Super Speedway.
Mm-hmm.
So the goal is to go out, run Gateway, maybe go to Kentucky, Michigan, then come back to Talladega. We've got some stuff heated up out in Las Vegas. Heaven forbid I have to go to Las Vegas to make a start this year.
That'd be awful, wouldn't
it? Yeah, I know. But we got some really cool things happening. But, I'm really more focused right now on kind of our campaign that we're going to talk about. And the race and stuff, it's great. We get to do that later in the year. But this is kind of what's leading the way for me right now.
Very cool. So what is it that has got you so fired up here? And I know where it's going, and I'm here to tell you I'm 100% behind you on this.
Yeah.
It's been something I've wanted to do my entire life. I think for 25 years I've had to deal with the idea of suicide. It's been in my family, basically how I got started in racing, my grandfather. They were back in the days with Donnie and Bo Anthony, and he crew chiefed the car. And, he was going to do the same deal, graduate high school, just like Bobby did Davey, and then we'll go racing. And I would have had there's no telling what I'd be doing right now, you know, but we didn't get that opportunity. You know, he passed away. I think I was a sophomore in high school. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's such a struggle. We talked about Talladega and the ARCA series last year. I was like 24 hours away from missing that race. I had a deal lined up. It fell through.
Right.
And then in 24 hours, we found the funding to drive the 06 car. And then not too long after that, the primary sponsor didn't pay their bill. So it was, you know, and I sat there and I said, you know, I don't have much more. I don't think I can take much more of this without having to bring in a couple of psychiatrists to help continue staying in the sport. So I said, this is it. I've done some work with the American Foundation for Suicide Prevention over the last couple of years, kind of learning everything about what they do. And it just comes a point where you have to be ready to go out there and talk about it. And it just kind of made sense this year. And then they've got a new area director, Ashley Foster. So we kind of talked, and it was really fast. This whole thing has really happened fast. It's nice. Great too, but it was like 2 days later we had a meeting with New York, and they gave us the approval and love what we're doing, and they want to be in NASCAR. So
nice.
They're allowing me to kind of put it together, and they're supporting us. So we run everything by them before we do it.
Right.
But every time it's there to go for it. So.
Okay. So immediate plans are then to make sure that they're prominently featured on the car in whatever race you're going to be in.
Yeah, everything has changed so much. Originally, this was going to be a donor type situation through mm-hmm. the foundation to race to have their name on the truck.
Okay.
Well, now everything that we do with the foundation is, you know, this is just the way it's kind of evolved my ideas of the thing. Everything that I do with the foundation, 100% of that money is going back to them.
Nice.
We've got concerts. A concert coming up February 18th or February 19th at Rio's Bar and Grill. Mm-hmm. I've got three awesome acts coming out there. You know, we're going to look for a $10 donation at the mm-hmm. door. But we have Sam Edwards, who, a good friend of mine, used to work at the Dale Jarrett Racing Adventure with me. Sam's now playing music. We have an awesome artist, Megan T. McMillan. She is amazing. And then David Hill and James Hodges from Cotton Box Road. If you've never heard Bamatized, you need to get on there and check it out, because it talks about, it's nothing but Bama and Alabama racing. So it's one of my favorite bands out there. And we have all these people on Racing Awareness, our Facebook page, Racing Awareness.
You mentioned Rio's. Rio's, I know where it is because I live like 5 minutes away from there. It's not even the crow flies. I mean, I could literally drive there in 5 minutes, but it's a little off the beaten path. Kind of describe where it is. Or would you rather me do that?
Well, yeah, we'll have the address and stuff like that available for everybody. Racing Awareness.com. We haven't got everything officially up on that, but like I said, the Facebook page has got a preview of all our artists. We'll have the flyer up and posted, and it'll be on the .com site here soon. We haven't really decided on a time yet.
Okay.
And then the next cool event we're doing is March 19th, Autobahn Speedway.
Yeah.
Everybody that comes to the door, we'll have a promotional code when you come to the door. 22% goes back directly to the foundation.
Nice.
So
nice.
we're going to do an event once a month, and right now that's kind of where I'm getting my clarity right now is working with this campaign that could possibly turn to a foundation eventually.
Right. This was something, and I say that I'm very familiar with it because I started to get to talking with police in both Alabaster and Helena, and they'd been talking about how suicide had become something of actually fairly big problem in areas where you normally wouldn't think of something like that becoming a problem. And I remember talking to Detective Chris Rowland from the Helena Police Department on the air on our sister station, WDJC, and talking about suicide. And we actually had a number of people that called and either wanted to get help or wanted to get someone that they knew some help. So I know about this, and it's a very scary thing, and we need to be much more aware of how this goes. And it's that thing, if you start a small spark, you hope in this case it will turn into the fire, as opposed to, you know, wildfires and things like that. We want this to turn into a big, humongous fire, and that people understand that we put light on this and that there are people out there that are really suffering. They do sometimes an amazing job of hiding how much truly they are suffering, and you don't know anything until, unfortunately, it's too late.
Exactly, and we've lost some really close friends over the years, and that's something that you know, kind of sparked this even more, sitting back and not saying anything, because I've seen it from both sides of the fence. It's been again, 25 years of my life. So if you get a platform, which I don't have much of one in racing, but we're trying to use what we do have to our advantage. We're blessed enough to have any opportunity. So this is something that, and it's awesome how this is growing again so fast. I guess it didn't give you a timeline of where we've gotten today, but I've got race car drivers from all over coming and wanting to join this program.
Nice.
So and I haven't even evolved it to that point yet to understand how can I get other drivers in. Well, now, for example, like Daytona, I partner with my good friend Gene Paul, ESP Motorsports. Gene is going to have our logo on the car, Racing for Awareness.
Nice.
Which, you know, here we are a month in, and I'm going to have my logo on a race car. And what he's going to do in return for the foundation is any sponsor that jumps on the car through us, he's going to donate 10% of that money back to the foundation.
Awesome.
So it's all about raising money and awareness. I have a young kid from the St. Louis area. His father's reached out to us. They've dealt with suicide on multiple occasions, and they want to support the program. So there's country music artists that we talked about. Megan, Sam, David, these guys are not, they're coming out just to support us, not charging us a thing to support the campaign, to support the program. So racing is wonderful. I love it. It got, you know, little bit I've got to do has got me to this point, but I'm so excited to see how far this is going to go, where we sit this time next year talking about this. So we're obviously going to get in racing mode when time comes. We're out there. We've got a few really good opportunities sponsor-wise, but we have to think about it as a business. Why would you spend $50,000 to drive for someone when you can spend $15,000? My goal is to stay out of the way. We want to get Super Speedway approved. And they all want to talk to you about, well, this truck and the setup and this. And I'm like, look, I have a job for a living. I'm not a race car driver for a living. So we're just going to ride around and get our approvals, get to Talladega and match the gas. I mean, those tracks right there, obviously you can evens the playing field. If you got enough ponies on the hood, then we can really get after it. So that's what our game plan is. Get us an opportunity, get to Talladega. Know the line there. No, I'm just kidding. that's it. I mean, we get to Talladega, we can really open one up and see what we can do. And, you know, so that's what my main focus is. The tracks we do before is going to make NASCAR happy. Mm-hmm. And then we open the can up at Talladega.
It brings up an interesting question. You got to get all the clearances and approvals and get your laps in and things like that. What is that process of getting a NASCAR license?
First, there's a lot. You know, experience-wise, and I got very lucky that I'm a professional salesman, and Brett Bodine, he wasn't going to give me a license in the beginning, but I had to sell Brett on the idea of what we were doing, what we're trying to accomplish, and I think that goes to my age. I mean, you know, a little bit more smart about what the situation is. We're not there to go out and cause any problems, and I mean, once you get to that point, you've passed all your tests and whatever, NASCAR's gave you the thumbs up. They want you to run a track under a mile, and then it's a mile and a half. I don't know if they'll do a 2 mile after that before they let us go to Talladega, but there's also the opportunity that we could, and I'm not saying we won't, but we could run the Talladega ARCA race, just depending on how things go, if that helps us get the clearance to run the truck race. So that's all I care about this year. Nothing against the other tracks that we go to, and not that we're not going to be competitive. We're going to run the full distance everywhere we go, but, you know, it's Talladega, it's home, the equalizer being the draft. So that's what, you know, this whole year is about. And then once that's finished, my girlfriend's giving me the okay to run Homestead if it all works out, because she wants to go down the Keys.
She's an Ender.
She wants to go on vacation. But
it'd be a nice little place to go right there,
wouldn't
it?
Hey, we can go on vacation, and you can go ahead and race, and it's just a two-for-one deal.
That's right.
But, you know, after Talladega, we want to really focus on Daytona for 2018, so that would be just awesome.
Okay, so Gateway is June 17th, and I'm just kind of looking here. I know that the trucks have run Michigan, August.
Yeah.
August 12th, so there's a two-miler right there.
So it would go Gateway, Kentucky,
Kentucky
Michigan,
is
Talladega.
July 6th. Michigan's August 12th, and then where?
Talladega after Michigan.
And then Talladega, which would be in October 14th.
Yep.
And then that leads us to 40 change, Go Blues 200 November 17th.
That could change drastically according to what Brett tells me we can do.
Mm-hmm.
Amazingly, it's cheaper to run the Xfinity series than it is the truck series.
Is it really?
Absolutely. So wow. I had a deal.
One would not have thought that.
Wow. I thought it maybe stepped up a little bit.
I know.
Well, you have some. Now, don't get me wrong. Joe Gibbs is, I think it's $190,000 a race. Okay. But there are teams like, for example, Carl Long is a really good guy.
Yes.
Carl, because the Xfinity series pays more money, he charges the driver less. So it's like $18,000 to $20,000 to run an Xfinity race, and it's $26,000 to $30,000 to run a truck race because it pays out less. So I went to NASCAR and I said, look, we can just bypass the truck race. I'm thinking economically,
right?
Let's go where it's cheaper and it's better, the Xfinity series. But no, Brett said, Joey, stay on track of what you want to do. You want to get Super Speedway cleared, just stay focused on that. Let's get you through that, then you'll be ready to go the other series. So, but I was excited. I thought we had a chance to go. I thought I could sell him on that, but no, he's on his ground. No.
But while not totally sold on it, I mean, he is sold on what it is that you're trying to do as far as not only your particular side of the racing career, but also how you're trying to raise awareness for this as well. Is this a double-edged thing? I mean, was all of that included in there?
No, because the whole thing with this foundation and everything, I literally cannot tell you how fast this has happened. It's been, I guess we've been working on a couple of months, and we've been working on trying to get back into racing since the last time we got out, you know, trying to plan. You have to be a year ahead of what you're going to do, if not more. So, that's when this all kind of happened, I just stopped. I put the brakes on the race, and I'm not chasing sponsors and stuff right now. I'm chasing, these events, you know, and getting our website up. And there's so much that goes into this. I want this to be around for a long time, whether I'm in a race car or not. There's other people that are driving race cars. Matt can drive around. We can raise awareness. This is a great program that, again, I'm still working right now, I went to bed and had a dream about it last night, trying to figure out how we can still, I want to bring drivers in and give them an option, you know, but you also have to be very cautious of who you allow to represent you. And there's a lot of people. That. Yeah. You could use a tier advance. So we just, we have to really watch that. And it's happening so fast. Again, I just don't want to, jump out too soon with too many different new entities to what we're doing. I want to kind of keep on track and let these things evolve. The good Lord's kind of driving this ship.
Yeah.
I'm just here. And these ideas keep coming. And just like we didn't understand how, because when you deal with a foundation, there's a separation. You can't, we couldn't go around saying we're the American Foundation for Suicide.
Right.
So we had to find a way to go out and sell our programs, so Racing for Awareness.
But that said, God is working through you.
Jumped Up is available on Google.
That's right.
So next month, about a month from right now, is the first
Rio's
event.
Boring Girl. Yep.
All right. And we're going to make sure that as soon as we get all the information, we'll post it onto the Facebook page for Fastest Hour and Radio, Twitter, and all the other social media that we have, and we'll be there.
What's that website one more time for Racing for Awareness?
It's www.racingforawareness.com. You can check out our Facebook page through there, our Twitter account. Everything's there for you. Our news will be updated soon, but majority of everything's on our Facebook page. You can check out all our great artists. Autobahn Speedway announcements should be coming next week.
We'll make sure we have all that linked, and we'll link to your Facebook page as
well.
All right, very cool. Joey, thank you very much. We appreciate you coming in. Welcome anytime. Thank you for listening.
See ya!